As it was in the legend of St. George and the Dragon, the European Union is nothing less than a plague-wielding dragon, feeding on the welfare of the European people. And as it was in that very same legend, those that chose to remain under the dragon's control would vote to turn over everything to that dragon. And now, that dragon is on a short leash, meekly begging for a second chance so it can destroy everything in its path. Kurt Nimmo writes, "The establishment is pushing a buyer's remorse narrative in the wake of Brexit, and the globalist George Soros is leading the charge." Soros said during the annual meeting of the European Council of Foreign Relations, "It was in general what you call buyer's remorse. It included everyone, the people who voted for leave, those who voted for remain, and those who didn't vote." According to Soros, the British people are not serious about leaving the EU. They simply want to express their discontent with their political situation in Europe. And now that Brexit is a reality, they are demonstrating buyer's remorse. The corporate media has adopted Soros's narrative.
Is there any chance of a second referendum? Is there any going back?
There's a lot of buyer's remorse, and there's a lot of concern amongst the Remainers, obviously.
ABC News points to a Servation poll conducted for the Mail on Sunday after the Brexit vote. It claims of the 17.4 million who voted to leave, 1.1 million actually wished they had voted remain. And the New York Times went one step further and offered various ways to renege on the vote. For instance, the new prime minister might refuse to invoke Article 50 of the European Union's governing treaty and instead act like the vote never happened.
Because if we're going to wait for a successor to David Cameron, further thinking, and we're not going to invoke Article 50 or start the serious renegotiation of our trade relationship until later on this year, actually that is a period of indecision.
Another escape hatch might be the parliaments of Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales refusing to approve Brexit. On Monday, an online petition calling for a second vote had 3.8 million signatures. Paul Manafort, Donald Trump's campaign manager, said Brexit represents a rejection of globalism and faceless bureaucrats ruling the lives of millions of people. However, globalist shill President Barack Obama would have the American people led astray yet again.
I think it's important to remember that Mr. Trump embodies global elites and has taken full advantage of it his entire life. And so he's hardly a spokesperson for a legitimate spokesperson for a populist surge from working class people on either side of the Atlantic.
Meanwhile, the humiliated, arrogant swine running the EU are unveiling their blueprint for an EU superstate. Nothing less than a sovereign corroding ultimatum that would propose that member EU countries would lose their right to their own army, criminal law, taxation system, immigration system, and the illusion of the control of their central bank. An all-encompassing totalitarian state that has been in the works all along. The Express UK reports excerpts of the 9-page EU superstate report were published today as the leaders of Germany, France, and Italy met in Berlin for Brexit crisis talks. In the preamble to the text, the two ministers write, "Our countries share a common destiny and a common set of values that give rise to an even closer union between our citizens." Immediately after the Brexit, many people in England texted, "What is the European Union?" Well, simply put, the European Union was created in 1955 at Bilderberg by the very same globalists that have risen to their current status as the enemy of humankind, fomenting quiet wars, utilizing a myriad of weapons in order to establish a new world order, which those very same globalists are incredibly close to finalizing. And now the rest of Europe is following Great Britain's lead. If the British people do fold under the weight of doom and gloom shelled out by the very globalists they're trying to escape from and return like frightened children to their sociopathic mummy and daddy at the EU, the imaginary consequences the mainstream media would have the British people frightened of now would become very real in the near future, resulting in complete and total submission under a European superstate run by unelected bureaucrats in Brussels so arrogant and powerful, England would cease to exist. It is the EU that must cease to exist. John Bound for Infowars.com.
While we were ending the broadcast yesterday on Tuesday, Donald Trump was giving a speech on declaring America's economic independence. And I was intending on the 4th of July to have a rebroadcast of some of our biggest and most important interviews. But I'm tempted to come in the next few days and tape a special broadcast about NAFTA and GATT and the WTO and the IMF and the World Bank and the TPP and all the rest of it and break down in their own words how they're establishing a corporate world government. Because this speech is the best I've ever seen in my lifetime against globalism. He points out that Hillary is a foreign agent of the Chinese. He says that she is an agent in a trade war against us. These are quotes. He says, if I get elected, the era of American economic surrender is over. He says they threaten us with trade war. Ladies and gentlemen, we're already in a trade war. We're already under attack. We're already having our jobs sold off to the communist Chinese. Hillary is an agent and has been an agent since the communist Chinese were funding money through Don Tyson of Tyson Chicken, who ran the Clintons. They were formerly CIA. That's been leaked. They were handled by Strobe Talbot at Oxford. But the globalists allowed them to operate at that level as double agents because Henry Kissinger, who they're best friends with and they vacation with, and the Bushes, Bush Sr. was the first ambassador to China after relations opened back up. They made a traitorous, high-level, unilateral deal that Nixon wasn't even aware of and tried to end. That's why they basically impeached him and set him up. He wasn't an angel, but he said, what, you've made a bunch of secret deals, Kissinger? You're in trouble. And Kissinger's like, no, you're in trouble. We control the press. Bye-bye. But this goes back to what happened in the 1970s. You wonder why the Bushes are in charge? You wonder why the Clintons are in charge? You wonder why they call themselves family? You want to know why we just can't seem to get rid of them like a bad case of herpes? It's because they are literally on the payroll of the communist Chinese. That's really who controls them. They also get financed to a great extent by the Saudi Arabians. There's an Israel lobby, but it's mainly about Israel. And it does bad stuff. It gets our secrets and sells it to the Chinese as well. I mean, Israel, to a great extent, is working for the Chinese. $1.5 billion of them, folks, almost $1.5 billion. And they're used as slaves. They have no rights. They have no economic future other than being chattel. They're very smart, hardworking people. So they're the perfect robot army. China is the first robot army. The globalists wanted hundreds of millions of slaves. They've got them. Hundreds of millions of workers. I mean, it's got to be 600, 700 million workers out of 1.4 billion Chinese. And they have got them. And they are leveraging out all of our jobs, all of our factories, all of our future, everything from animation to silicon, to drugs, to prescription drugs, to rare earth minerals, to electronics. It's all going to be China. China is already 97 to 98%, depending on the year, in control of rare earth minerals. Strategically, the globalists do not allow the UK or Germany or France or the US or Canada or Australia to be involved in rare earth minerals. China has been given it in a global treaty. They've been given the Panama Canal and almost all of our deep water ports. They've been given the separation systems, the launch boost systems, the guidance systems, the reentry systems, the MIRV systems, the warhead systems, the targeting systems, the GPS systems, the keys to everything, backdoor codes to all the chips. We are wide open. You've got that demonic Communist Party Politburo and Central Committee passing power down since the 1930s when Mao had rebels up in the mountains, when he took over in 1949 and started killing 84 million people over the next 15 years. And criminal elements of our CIA put him in. That's now been declassified 10 years ago. Declassified in 2005. Look it up. We knew about it because the John Birch Society blew the whistle when they were founded in the 1950s because of that. Because of U.S. agents who were in the CIA and OSS before that who wouldn't be part of it, Army officers and others that were tortured and killed. And Christian mercenaries and other groups. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, this is completely and totally out of control. Because the Chinese won't share power. They won't allow infiltration. They keep it centralized amongst less than 100 families that have set up a new form of royalty called communism. They teach the intellectual morons at colleges that that's for the people. What complete idiots. You think North Korea, China, or Venezuela is for the people? Or Cuba? What morons. No wonder you're such losers. And Donald Trump gets up there and says China is in a trade war with us. China is shutting us down. Our elites have sold out our industrial base as a tool of control. And Hillary is an agent against us in that trade war. That's a quote. Hillary is an agent against us in that trade war. We're going to be playing some of these clips coming up at the bottom of this hour. But what I think I'm going to do is actually tape a show in the next few days for Sunday. And even if you can't watch it Sunday, if you're with family or whatever, you can then post it as a video report Sunday evening for everybody to share on 4th of July as a special 4th of July message of the tyranny and of a new Declaration of Independence, 1776, Part 2, that I called for 5 years ago that Matt Drudge picked up and, of course, promulgated, that many top lawyers and scholars and constitutionalists said was dead on a plan on trade, on nation states, on our individual states to take the federal government back over, dissolve it, then reconstitute it and reorganize it. And that's what Donald Trump's talking about right now. We are overrun. We have foreign interests now in control of Washington, turning the 16 intelligence agencies and all of our tax money against us to train us to be slaves and prisoners in our own country, financing our own serfdom while the borders are wide open and 10,000 Chinese women get here a week and more than 10,000 a month have their babies for free. That's even CNN and they're made citizens. We are being colonized by wealthy Chinese. That's the headline in the Chinese Daily. Wealthy Chinese coming here to have their children. And they are Communist Party members. They come here and they get everything free and then they burrow in with over 10,000 front companies that were known about by the late 90s. Who knows what it is, 20, 30,000 now. And let me tell you how this works, folks. It's a mafia. We have had, in two separate cases, Communist Chinese try to control what we say and do here, including infiltration. We have had the Communist Chinese try to shut Paul Watson down with threats. And I mean real threats in London. I'm going to stop right there. He said, don't want me to talk about it. But it's like a James Bond movie, okay? This isn't a game, people. It isn't a game. Michael Savage couldn't get his book put in bookstores anywhere. He's been a number one New York Times bestseller. I don't want to exaggerate. I think he had like 14 or 15 books when he was an herbologist. He's a doctor of that. And then he has five or six others that were number one, political. He couldn't sell a few thousand. No one would sell them in bookstores. He sold, of course, hundreds of thousands of his listeners. Michael Savage, by the way, doesn't need the money. He is founded and controls, and he didn't really brag about this, some of the biggest herb companies and things out there. I'm just going to stop right there. But the point, yeah, the guy's worth billions. The point is he's there putting these books out to warn you, and he doesn't need the money. Okay? He doesn't need to sell the books. But I'm digressing. The Chinese government threatened the publisher. This all came out and basically shut down the distribution. And he came on the show and talked about it and no one even cared. Born in the USA, why Chinese birth tourism is booming in California, Huffington Post. Oh, it's so wonderful. Ha, ha, ha. It's all a joke. You go to China and want something free, they will let you starve to death in a ditch. You you go to the park and practice Buddhism and start meditating, you within an hour will be in a jail cell, and within a year, you will have your organs harvested. Meanwhile, we're obsessed with tranny bathrooms over here as a psychological warfare just to totally break us down and make us a total joke. What happened while the Chinese communists took over America? Oh, we obsessed over teaching five-year-olds that they could be a woman if they're a man. They could be a man if they were a woman, just to jack with them, you know. And we obsessed with men having big beards. I don't care if you have a big beard. It's just like, that's all we care about. Big beards and trannies and acting cool. And what did Seinfeld say? And Jimmy Fallon says, you down with TPP? Obama goes, you know me. It's fun and cute to have foreign banks and the communist Chinese, you know, involved in all this, running us with unelected secret groups. Because you know what? They got a great jazz band up there with Obama wearing a sharp $10,000 suit with Jimmy Fallon. And it's all cute and funny, and they're suave while they steal your future as actual foreign operatives, destroying you and your future. And Trump is standing against it. I don't want to thumbprint to buy and sell. Well, no, ABC News says soon everyone will accept a chip. I'll make an intro video showing all the news now going, of course you'll have chips in your body to buy and sell. Only conspiracy theorists are against it. Oh, I thought we were conspiracy theorists for reading DARPA reports 20-something years ago saying that was the goal, was to have everything in the real third dimension tracked by smart dust that is RFID, basically, so that there's an Internet of Things and everything is tracked in real time so they could put that through supercomputers and predict the future and then guide the future. I was told that by NSA whistleblowers 20 years ago, 18 years ago, 17 years ago, 16 years ago, when I'd be doing a live broadcast at a car show or a rodeo, or I'd be signing DVDs at a movie event premiere, and I'd be going out to get my car, it was always the same. Just like Matt Drudge says, the only way to give somebody info under the radar is to meet in a parking garage. Almost every time, it'd be someone in a parking garage that I guess had been following me, and they would just tell me stuff or give me documents. And, of course, I'd show my dad, and he'd say, shred that immediately. And then I would go on air, though, and talk about what I'd seen, and all hell would break loose. I mean, I'd walk out in the parking lot of Access TV, like, 19 years ago, and there'd be Army soldiers in plain clothes going, what you planning, Alex? You got a team, a terror team, to attack something? I'd be like, what are you talking about? And even then, I could tell, because it started to happen, they were, like, military people. They'd be like, yeah, well, you better watch it, Alex. You better watch it. I'd be coming out of the radio studio, and there'd be like, you know, two FBI agents going, hey, Alex, what you planning? Planning anything bad? I'd be like, no, who are you with? Well, you know who we're with. And, of course, they quit doing it, so they always started carrying a camera or sticking it in their face. But I remember having these engineers go, they've already got cameras in the TVs and microphones. Open up the Scientific Atlantic cable box they're installing. And I'd bust one open on air and on TV, and people couldn't believe it. We got death threats, you name it, hidden camera, hidden microphone. And now you just know that's a fact. Zuckerberg says, oh, of course they're watching you. Cover up your webcam. Cover up your Samsung TV. They're all doing it. And it's a global plan where all car manufacturers for at least 14 years are putting boxes in your car. They're going to tax you by the mile. And again, it's all pre-planned. And I'm just here telling you this. We've gone from me getting this info from I'm sitting there getting a beer and chili at like 9 at night. I've been on the air for 2 hours at the rodeo. And one of the same guys that gave me info is like, hey, Alex, hey, how you doing? You need to understand you're not getting it right. It's about predicting the future. It's about predicting the future. If there's a trend coming up, they want to know to control it, whether they want to kill it or take control of it to make money to then consolidate the economy. But once they can predict the future, they can add stimuli to control the future, control the future. And it's like you're in a science fiction movie. You're going, okay, well, that kind of makes sense. Isn't that like an Isaac Asimov book? Yes, exactly. That was the World Futurist Society preparing the public for the program. These weren't like crazy guys. They'd like get in $150,000 Mercedes and stuff and drive off. I mean, these were top engineers that were totally freaked out because they were the ones wiring all the AI in. And the more I'd talk about it, the more these engineers would bring me stuff because they cared, man. They were like inside Time Warner, inside. One of them was told me he was with AT&T, and he goes, "We aren't listened to by the NSA, Mr. Jones. We are the NSA. Their whole floor is at all our major hub facilities. We are the NSA. Everything passes through it. There are NSA offices that then break it up and send it to the other agencies." All that came out 6-7 years ago, exactly as I told you, because I was getting it directly from the corporate mercs who were in the briefings and the meetings about how it was to control the future, dominate society towards the end of actuarying the economy to shut down all grassroots economies. They're going to regulate and tax where it's impossible for you to operate. So when you're forced to work for them or go on welfare, you can be socially engineered. And what did they just give a Nobel Prize to this this professor a few years ago? He just spoke at Bilderberg. You know, he developed the precariat. Oh, we've made the public precarious and dependent. Let's use that with a universal monthly payment that everyone gets. It'll finally be globally to socially control people. Oh my gosh, they put us on welfare to control us? No, give him a Pulitzer Prize on top of it. So this is their plan. This is their program. And Trump is for real because they don't want these issues brought up. Do you think he's a shill bringing up that Hillary's a communist Chinese agent? We've got the video straight ahead. I'm telling you, this is epic. Stay with us. Now compare Hillary to Trump. Look at this witch compared to this patriot that many were being taken over by the communist Chinese.
We came, we saw,
put Al-Qaeda in charge,
and died.
And they invented Syria.
We came,
and they invented Europe.
We saw, and died.
And there's more terror attacks the media won't even call this a Islamic attack in Turkey.
We saw, and died. We came, we saw, and died.
What difference does it make?
It's not a laughing matter. I take it really seriously. Vote for me because I'm a woman. One of my merits is I'm a woman. Not all these mothers vote for me because I'm a woman.
Well, they put a Buddhist woman in the back of a van to have her organs cut off for being Buddhist. In China, you're a woman. Saudi Arabia gives you $100 million. You're a woman.
Woman running to be the first woman president.
Woman. Woman.
Woman. Woman. Who can be more of an outsider than a woman president? I can't think of anything more of an outsider than electing the first woman president.
A woman president of the United States.
A woman president like Merkel.
Women.
You would have a girl, would you? Woman. Isn't that just special? Isn't she just a sweetie pie? Meanwhile, ladies and gentlemen, Hillary helped with Clinton give nuclear reactors to North Korea. You can look it up via ABB. That allowed them to produce atomic and now hydrogen bombs. That's on record. And she gave all the missile secrets to the Chinese so they could get their Long March ICBM, that's an intercontinental ballistic missile, off the ground and allow it to come back into the atmosphere and deliver multiple warhead payloads into multiple military bases and cities. So Hillary's, I mean, anyone else caught doing that would be executed. But it's okay because George Herbert Walker Bush made the deal when he was the ambassador living in China for 4 years. And they brought the Clintons in for that whole shell operation so that Bush Sr. could have a couple more administrations but have left cover. He couldn't get his New World Order through because he was a Republican, supposedly. So he put a Democrat in to get the agenda through. And now that's all we're seeing today is an attempt of the communist Chinese. Out of all the special interests out there, it's them. And I've talked to a lot of big insiders. I got a couple of military calls the other day, and they go, is Tim Kennedy telling you this stuff? It's like, did you just tune into the show? We have Cy Hirsch on the broadcast. We've had Daniel Ellsberg on. We have all these generals and colonels on. We have all these sources. I've done my own research. Most of this stuff is public data. So, no, I'm not getting any of this from Tim Kennedy. I mean, at that level of special forces, they get a lot of info on a mission, but not on the big picture. He's a smart guy and has his own worldview, but people are like, well, you say you have a source on this. Yeah, like on Benghazi, our sources were so good, we told you everything that happened there before anybody else. People go, well, give us your sources. Some of them came on publicly, Dr. Pechenik, Colonel Schaefer, and others, Tosh Plumley. Others didn't. But it doesn't matter. The fact is, the proof is in the pudding. You judge a tree by its fruits. But I'm digressing here. I want to get into Trump and his epic speech yesterday on redeclaring our economic independence. We've been conquered economically. Deals were made. How do you bring down the U.S.? Our elites make a deal with the communist Chinese. They keep the U.S. militarily dominant to a certain extent to hold them in check. They're allowed to be economically dominant. That's how globalism works. They have a systematic system. Kissinger's written books about this. They don't even deny this. To play those two forces off against each other while you integrate their power structures. And then you wage war against the general population itself, consolidating control. And now they're, from China to the EU to the United States, rolling out with robots to replace what's left of factory workers, even when the robots don't work a third as good, to make us totally dependent. That's the name of the game at every single front. So before I get into the Donald Trump speech and the rest of it, I am going to talk about a win-win here and something that's very important. I want people to listen to me very, very carefully. If everything they're doing is to make us dependent, while government builds unprecedented bunkers, while elites build armored redoubts and getaway hideouts, and helicopter and aircraft airfields in the middle of nowhere, while they admit they're preparing for economic collapse, you have to understand, it's all about taking us into a controlled collapse, beta testing it nation by nation, then bringing in a big collapse that happens globally, and managing all that to bring in total control on the ashes of the old order. And that's what even Soros is saying they're going to do. I've read their books. I've read their writings. Again, what I'm telling you is not my opinion. It is a boil down of what they say and what they're doing. So it's my perspective on their statements, but it's dead on. That's why so many foreign governments and intelligence agencies are on record listening to this show. Because everything else is meant to be deceptive and twisted and fake. That's the globalist plan, is to have so much disinfo that even the opposition is running down rabbit trails and doesn't even know what they're talking about. We have cracked the code. We actually read hundreds of globalist books and publications and white papers. I mean, I read Council on Foreign Relations, Foreign Affairs. It's a bi-monthly book. They call it a journal. And Paul Watson reads it. And they come out and say, yes, we're geoengineering with aluminum salts, barium dioxide to change the atmosphere. Yes, we're going to end the family. Yes, we're running Al-Qaeda in Syria. The headline was why we need Al-Qaeda a few years ago. Yes, we're bringing in planetary government. Yes, we should have a revolution of the elite against the people and totally take their resources so we can control them. That's in a Council on Foreign Relations article today. It's up on Infowars.com. He actually says, you're the enemy. We're going to take your resources to enslave you. And the German president came out this Sunday and said, we need to have a war basically against the people. It's the people's fault, not us. When they're openly trying to manage things to shut off the resources. I mean, they have declarations of their hatred for us. They have declarations of what they're doing to us. And All I can tell you is hope for the best, prepare for the worst. Look at these headlines. FEMA contractor predicts social unrest caused by 395% food price spikes. And this is Vice reporting on this. It talks about it a few days ago. And they're like, well, we're saying this is a scenario that could happen with future trends. And I showed you in the Ministry of Defense and the Pentagon reports from 2006 and 7, they predicted by this year and next year a 10-year trend would start for global collapse with most governments overthrown if they didn't clamp down and get control with food prices exploding. Then I went into how the globalists are orchestrating those collapses at the same time. So this is kind of how they put it out to the public. Oh, it's a scenario with a bunch of governments in NATO and the World Bank and IMF of 395% food price spikes over the next decade that will cause governments to collapse. And thank God FEMA and all these agencies are here to keep us safe from crop failure to system failure. While they incentivize from Brazil to the United States, from Germany to Ukraine to Japan to turn corn into ethanol and to destroy not just the food, but the food chain delivering us that food because they planted GMO crops that others wouldn't accept to set the precedent to have those crops everywhere. And they believe their global revolution against humanity will be somewhat complete by 2027. That's when the crisis ends. And then 2030 comes in, Agenda 2030, and that is the exterminism program. And when you know what you're reading, when you read this FEMA report, because then we can back it up. I have a special report coming up later today where I index all of this with the documents for you. You might want to listen. It's so epic. I just cannot believe this. These people are out of control. Look at this one. This is inside a secret government warehouse prepped for health catastrophes. And then I have another one here that's up on Infowars.com today dealing with what's the government preparing for? Michael Snyder, you may not be getting prepared for a major national disaster, but the government is. And he goes through all the links where they're preparing and NPR's reporting on the bunkers and the food and the hazmat suits and the body bags and at a level many times what it's ever been before. Is it Yellowstone's going to blow? Mount St. Helens? That overdue California quake? I don't know, but this stuff happens. They have such goldfish memories, though, people don't remember. But I believe it's all a cover for an economic collapse. And you have the Army publicly hiring resettlement specialists, 2010, classified, declassified 2013. And people couldn't believe our article for a week. It was linked to army.mil. And then the Army later said, we accidentally declassified it on our website. No, a patriot leaked it. Just like they accidentally declassified Operation Northwoods 9 months before 9/11. If you don't know what Operation Northwoods is, folks, I would look it up. But for this point, I've got to move on for folks that didn't miss the earlier courses on reality. All I know is I put in more solar generators at my house today, the very ones we sell at InfoWarsStore.com. They're the very best, highest quality units out there you're going to find anywhere. Just go find them. They're there at InfoWarsStore.com. I put in storable food for a few months for each crew member of this operation in our warehouse. I'm going to up that to like 3 or 4 months. I'm getting medical supplies. I'm getting other communication systems and a communication specialist to be able to communicate via shortwave and ham radio just in case, because they're planning in the final revolution to bring in a worldwide extended depression. And we need to be on the air during that at least as long as possible. Now, I don't think it's going to be super intense in some areas. They have some cities that are somewhat controlled and are safe havens for the globalists. Austin has been designated as a quasi-safe haven. Power is guaranteed to the downtown Capital District and Tarrytown as a COG continuity of government program, just like certain districts in Maryland around Site R are. So I have moved in, again, back into the city to run operations right on the border with their sites. And that's how serious our COG is for the info war. I mean, this is a organic military operation against the globalists. That's what we're doing here. We're Americans. We're 1776. Of course there'd be a resistance. We're it, folks. You're it, the listeners. Our affiliates. This isn't a game. People just got to finally understand. I'm not up here trying to sound sensational. Reality is sensational. And in closing, it's a win-win. We get the highest quality storable foods that are clean and healthy and good at the very lowest prices you're going to find. And then the profit we make funds the information war. It's a 360 win. If you're not buying your shortwave radios and your solar systems and your gravity-fed filters and your survival supplies and your Hillary for President shirts at InfoWarsStore.com, you are not putting your money where it's going to have the biggest effect. And you're not getting the highest quality products because we neurotically, we treat you, I'm super, super, it's beyond superstitious. It's the way the universe works. I will not screw over anybody that hasn't done something to me. In fact, I'll step around somebody that screwed me over just to move on. I'm not even a very vengeful person. I used to be a little bit more. But I mean, here's the deal. It is metaphysical. It is a law. It is a rule. I will not sell you something that I don't believe is the very best quality that I haven't tested and used myself. So we usually only do this once a year, but we did it a few months ago. They had to stop because they ran out of food. It's freshly prepared up in Utah. I had to stop, and they've built back up again, and they said they could probably run it for a week or so, depending on how past sales are. So I called them yesterday and twisted their arm. I said, instead of 15% off, I want to go ahead and do 20 to 40% off. In fact, a lot of the InfoWars Select food at InfoWarsStore.com is 40% off. But some of the deals are 20. This is the best deal you're going to find anywhere. It's My Patriot Supply food. It's private labeled by us. Our sticker's put on it. And then we're legally, through contracts, allowed to go lower than anybody else does. And yes, this undercuts the entire market. I don't care. I want to sell the most, be able to fund the operation, and have you love it and know you did a great deal, because that just boosts my karma mojo. I don't get into new age stuff. I just use those terms because I'm a God-fearing person. I want to have the best deals. I'm a capitalist. So InfoWarsStore.com, a FEMA report predicts up to 395% increase in food prices that could trigger mass unrest. Now is the time to stock up on storable food for you and your family that you trust. Get 20 to 40% off on retail price of all InfoWars Select storable food. InfoWarsStore.com to help you get ready. All InfoWars Select foods have a shelf life of 25 years and are made in the USA. Get started preparing before food prices skyrocket. As they may do, with all the inflation, get 20 to 40% off all InfoWars Select storable food on InfoWarsStore.com for a limited time while supplies last. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right there. And by the way, I've gone ahead. I'm going to sign the contract today. It's $30,000 for the RNC. It is $30,000 for the DNC. And we have hired aircraft for multiple days, four flights a day, with a gigantic banner itself that cost, what is it, $5,000. Hillary for President 2016, but really bold. And I think we're going to pay for another banner, too, that just says InfoWars.com. But we sold the shirts at $5 and sold out thousands of them, because that's it cost. We basically make no money on it. I think it's like 50 cents or something. So we make 50 cents on shipping or something, like Weldon was telling me. We need to fund this, so I need everybody to buy the shirts. We got 5,000 more of them, of the new design, Hillary for President 2016, and InfoWarsStore.com. This is the new design with InfoWars.com on the right shoulder in red. It's the same handsome design that everybody loves, but it's been tweaked because it's a collector's edition. They're $19.95. I need everybody to buy them at that price. Even if you already bought one, please buy another for your spouse, your neighbor, whatever, to spread the word. This meme is really causing the globalist problems, and I want to take the money from this. Because we don't really have it in the budget, but I just said, you know what, I'm going to ask folks to buy the shirts full price, and I think you're going to come through. Regardless, I'm going to sign the contract today. I'm going to sign the contract today for Cleveland. If we sell these in the next few weeks and I get the money for another $30,000 or so, I'm going to do Philadelphia. And look, will this save the world? No, but resistance is victory. This is one more action against the frickin' Chinese communist agent. I mean, literally, that's what she is. They'll be our president. But it's okay, because Jimmy Fallon makes jokes about the TPP being cool with Obama having foreign secret corporations run us. I mean, we are a joke, people. I want to just turn this around. Also, support our local affiliates. Become a sponsor, support your sponsors, or give them a donation. They are so important. Whatever you do, spread the word about InfoWars.com. The epic, historic Donald Trump speech is straight ahead. It is so powerful. He calls out the foreign agent, Hillary. All right, into the next hour, I'm going to be playing large excerpts of the historic Donald Trump speech. I'm also going to open the phones up for folks that want to specifically talk about the fact that we've been taken over by 21st century economic warfare. They've now established foreign multinational secret bureaus that are above the law, that are dictating our laws, just like the EU did to England. And we need to educate the public about that process and start withdrawing from it. They sit there and tell us that they're providing us everything. They sit there and tell us that they'll collapse our economy if we don't submit to them. Well, they plunged the stock market for 4 or 5 days. That didn't work. So now they've pumped it back up. It's totally rigged. And the good news is, a new national poll, 70%+ of Americans say they think the economy's rigged. Well, there's no think about it. It's admitted now that the Federal Reserve is private, that the interest rates are rigged, that the stock market's rigged. All of it's out in the open. It's just the dumb trendies have been told any knowledge is funny and something to be laughed at. Well, let's move on from those poor snot noses. But a lot of folks don't move on. They actually decide to feed on them. And it's a very, very sad thing to watch. But let's get rolling with this. The toll-free number to join us on air, specifically on economic warfare and Donald Trump's speech, 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. By the way, first-time callers in the first round of calls. Be first time, have a good phone, please. 800-259-9231. Now, this is a man standing up to the communist Chinese, who are the most important special interest with the globalists that have destroyed this country and made us dependent. And he's saying we're under economic warfare by design. They threaten to make it worse. We're already under attack. And he says she is an agent of that trade war against America. She is literally an agent of the Saudis and the communist Chinese. She is an arrogant James Bond villain. I mean, she is unbelievable. And she thinks the gimmick that she's a woman will make it okay. What was that old thing they said? They said, well, I knew Jack Kennedy, and you're no Jack Kennedy to, to George Herbert Walker Bush's running mate, Dan Quayle. Well, I've known a lot of women, Hillary, and you're no woman. You're a witch. Now let's go ahead and go out with 2 minutes of Trump. Here it is.
Hillary Clinton and her campaign of fear will try to spread the lie that these actions will start a trade war. We already have a trade war, and we're losing badly, badly.
That's right. You're already in a fight, folks. Fight back!
She has it completely backwards. Hillary Clinton unleashed a trade war against the American worker when she supported one terrible deal after another, from NAFTA to China to South Korea. It doesn't matter. No matter where she went, the American worker was hurt. And you will be hurt worse than ever before if she becomes president.
And then they gave money to her foundation. She sold us out for a few hundred million. It's unbelievable. We're so wide open.
A Trump administration will end that war by getting a fair deal for the American people and the American worker. The era of economic surrender will finally be over. It'll be over. You're not going to see it anymore. Although, I can't guarantee it, because after me, they'll probably start doing it again. But we will have 4 and maybe 8 great, great, great productive years, and we'll never go back, and we'll make sure we never go back.
The American system, the elite said over 200 years ago they had to stop it because they can't compete with it. This is just a resurgence. We're going to go to break. Let's take it back to the beginning. I want to play it again and then play large swaths of it. Folks, understand me. Understand me. This is real. This is historic. They wouldn't allow this to be said, okay? He is out of control. It's beautiful. We'll be back. They were strong. So they weren't threatened by others being strong. They based their systems on technological development, innovation, trailblazing. The globalists base their system on subterfuge, intrigue, and taking over systems. So many times in life, trying to develop funding mechanisms for InfoWars and just dealing with people out in the business world, you run into folks that actually want to develop economies and want to innovate and want to have 20, 30-year relationships with you, and are compulsive about being honorable. And those are always the people you see that actually run the local society and employ the people and put up with all the garbage, but have a sense of honor. And then there's always the corporate and governmental types that are there to just manage and bring in bureaucracies that then sit on top of you and feed off of you. And they're very unvirtuous type groups. And that's what the New World Order is. Donald Trump has given one of the most epic speeches ever. I backed it up a few minutes. We're going to play it again. I'm going to come back in the next segment and play like 5, 6, 7 minutes of it. It's so powerful. Where he says Hillary is an agent of a trade war against us, of China. Talk about throwing down the gauntlet. He slapped her upside her little head with it. And getting into the fact that we've already surrendered. We're already in a war. Stop letting them intimidate you that we're going to, you know, come after you financially if you don't submit. They've already been consolidating things and are so greedy, the globalists and the communist Chinese, they want managed economies and want you poor to control you. They're super uncool. It's not just like they want to take over our economy to make it better and leverage up some space colony program or something, because they think they'll build something better than us and we're some evil, you know, dumb idiot group of savages or something. No, they want to dominate us because we are so smart and innovative. The West. Super uncool, man. Super evil. In fact, I don't want to start it over and over again. I'll just come back after the break because it's a longer segment. Start it from the beginning. But I tell you, this is just an amazing time to be alive right now. And then I've got all this other news I haven't gotten to yet. Every day there's articles for the minions, for the liberals. These aren't attack pieces. With Michelle Obama and million-dollar villas, I mean, like $1 million to stay there for the weekend and 20 million, you know, for the vacation and lavish at palaces with just being gifted with hundreds of thousands of dollars of jewelry and clothing per day, meeting with royalty, eating the finest fattening meals. And then these people disconnect how, oh, the greedy rich aren't supposed to have any money. They mean their neighbor that has $10 more than them. That's the greedy rich. Or the guy that owns a car dealership, or somebody that owns a restaurant, or somebody that owns a little factory, or somebody that, you know, owns a little hotel or something. That's the big greedy guy, the person they kind of see at their level that they're angry at in class envy. But, oh, the movie stars and Hillary and, you know, worth hundreds of millions from foreign dictators and the Obamas. And it's always Michelle eating steaks and, you know, giant ribeyes and porterhouses and huge gravy meals and just jet copters and jumbo jets and red carpets and just, oh, the lavishness. But then they're like, but you have to live under austerity for the earth, and you can't fly because of the carbon. Now we feast. Michelle Obama and the girls are joined by Meryl Streep for lavish dinner with Moroccan princesses at Palace. And then it's got all the photos of it. And it's just these weird, hateful criminals that push communist ideology. She's like Kim Jong-un. I just detest her. I detest her. I worked out for a little over an hour this morning, and I was flipping between Fox News, CNN, MSNBC, and CNBC, mainly to miss the commercials, but also to monitor globalist transmissions. And even Fox News, I had to watch probably 30 minutes back and forth to hear them say that it was ISIS that took credit for the attacks yesterday at the Ataturk airport in Turkey that have killed 40-something people now. Bombings and shootings, and the U.S. already has its flights opened, unprecedented, back into it. But watching MSNBC and CNN and others, they were saying nothing. I mean, if a group of, say, right-wingers bombed something, that's all you'd hear. Or if some other group, they would tell you who was affiliated with it. ISIS took credit within an hour yesterday. That was in the foreign newspapers, but nowhere here in the United States. Just like with what happened in San Bernardino, what happened in the situation at the gay nightclub in Orlando, what happened with Major Hassan. But for 4 or 5 years, they said that wasn't a terror attack. The Army, Navy, Marine Corps recruiting centers, the cops getting shot by people yelling Allah Akbar in California and in Pennsylvania and in Toronto. I mean, this is happening all the time. You'll have a guy in traditional Muslim garb running around screaming Allah Akbar, shooting a cop in his patrol car for no reason. And then it's not Muslims. And it's just not right. Everybody knows that I tried to stop the Iraq war and all these invasions and stuff, because I knew it was part of a clash of civilizations to stir this up, because PNAC, Project for New American Century, wrote a multi-hundred-page white paper You can go read it online, detailing the plan, bipartisan, run by that creep Crystal, whose daddy was the head of the Trotskyites after Leon Trotsky got killed in Mexico with an ice hook, an ice hatchet. Old Stalin got his competitor. You are a competitor now. You shall die. And then we got that weird little creep running the conservative movement, hopping around. I mean, it's a joke. I remember I used to talk like 15 years ago about how William Crystal, was the head of the Trotskyites when they created the neocon movement in the 60s, and people didn't believe me. It's like, then it finally was like in the Wall Street Journal and stuff. People went, wow, they're communists? Yeah, they are. And then they merged with this weird Nazi, Leon Strauss, at Chicago Business School and, quote, became right-wing, adopting a Nazi philosophy of the end justifies the means and dictatorship. I mean, that's their words. It's like, wow. Wow. But it's the public's ignorance allows the sensationalism of this. George Soros admits he's behind part of the euro. He admits he wants to create a super state and take your rights. That's in the news. He's involved overthrowing Ukraine and actually putting Nazis in as the first president, unelected, who have rallies with images of blonde goddesses heiling Hitler, firing electricity bolts out of their fingers. Now, I mean, you think the Nazis were weird with nighttime rallies and torches and stuff to bring in all that symbolic mind control of tribalism. They have nighttime rallies with images with goddesses firing Emperor Palpatine, Darth Sidious lightning bolts out of their fingers. And by the way, if you're a new viewer or listener, I'm not joking. This isn't satire. You got a weird Jewish Nazi collaborator from World War II running around, who actually has a white cat and is on an oxygen tank half the time. He runs the Quantum Group, that is the name of Spectre's front group in the new James Bond movie. You're like, well, what, is he copying them? No, they're copying him. Because he basically is the head of Spectre. At the end of World War II, they talked about it, though, these shadowy groups that were like hydras. That's their symbol, is a hydra. So you see it in Captain America, you know, Hail Hydra. You see it in James Bond movies, Spectre. It's an octopus. It's a hydra. And you chop off one head, two more sprout. Yes, it's true. Well, until you understand, they have different political fronts, different names, different groups, but it's all basically just really evil people working together to create chaos so they can consolidate control. And then they turn around and screw each other over next because their honor is dishonor. And they never want you to know how their systems work. They don't want you to know about foreign governments manipulating. They don't want you to know how you're under trade wars. They don't want to know you. They don't want you to understand how they've set up the economy where small folks can't operate. And now they know that people are going to small mom and pops who understand that. So now they want to put taxes and regulations in where it's impossible. We just have to stop complying at that point. We've now reached that like the Border Patrol talked to us and said, yeah, the government ships in folks with TB. It's totally illegal. And talk to us on camera. They've gotten to the point where they're just done. They wouldn't talk to us a year ago on camera. It just takes going, you know what? You're lawless. I'm not following your orders anymore. Go ahead and try to put me in jail or fire me. You can't kill everybody like you did the Border Patrol agent that was going to expose Fast and Furious. You can't get everybody, can you, Hillary? George Soros, all of you. And if you're not careful and you knock off leaders in the liberty movement, then you turn them into martyrs. So you'd rather just assassinate us politically and assassinate our names, except you're so discredited, trying to assassinate us only makes us bigger. Whether you physically kill us or try to kill our name, all you do is make us stronger. So what do? You just accelerate dumbing people down as much as you can to make them so sick and mentally ill they can't resist. That's really your game plan, isn't it, Cupcake? But it was surreal to sit there. I don't really watch it. I listen to it while I'm working out. And to hear four different news channels talking about the attacks and how we need to give up more rights and have more funding for the intelligence agencies and you know, and more checkpoints at the TSA. And just like I said, they do years ago. I was watching Fox and I tuned to CNN, same deal. They were like, all talking points. That's when you know you're in trouble. One centralized system. They were saying they want to move the checkpoints out now, not at the TSA. They're going to check you there, but out at the parking lot or maybe at the end of the road. All the terrorists will do is always attack where the checkpoint is. That's why they always blow up the checkpoints. That's the target, dummy. There's more people compacted there than on an airplane. The government knows that. They're bringing them in. They're letting them attack because they've suspended common sense. They've suspended knowledge. They've suspended using your brain. They've destroyed logic. And so they go, we need to check you more at the TSA. We need to grope you more. But the border's wide open. We bring the people in. What? Excuse me? Oh, we're in a trade war with China. If we do anything back to them, even though they have tariffs on us that are built in illegally. Really? What is it made in China? What jobs do we have? Again, now they admit airport security, long lines, easy targets for terrorists. Mark Zuckerberg, better cover up your webcam and your smart TV. It's watching you. Oh, Zuckerberg, you've discovered it in 2016. You're so smart. He's running it. But let's play, and I want to go to your phone calls. This is part of this incredibly epic Donald Trump speech. But I think on the Sunday show, I'm going to air most of it with commentary. I think that's what I'm going to do. I wasn't going to go live Sunday. I think I'm going to do a special tape show for the 4th of July, but that airs on July 3rd on the eve of that. I'm going to skip this network break so I'm going to play part of this and come back and go to your calls. But here's Trump just doing things that show he's totally real, because what he's doing is irrevocable to Hydra, to Spectre, whatever you want to call the octopus. Because they don't want you even thinking about things above presidents. They don't want to have you thinking about, hey, a president could be a foreign agent. Foreign governments could try to take politicians and groom them to take control. That's why you have to be born in the country, because in the old days in Europe, they would do that too. All the common sense comes back. The globalists are in trouble. They only have victory when common sense is suspended. So this is Donald Trump telling total truth. In the speech, they're attacking him for it. He goes, I know, folks, I used to work in the system. I've used the system to become rich, but at your expense. And they go, and Obama came out and said, see, he criticizes a system he's become rich in. He isn't qualified as a worker or a person of the people to do this. Really, because he's wealthy, because he made money in the free market, he made money in service. There's nothing bad in that. He admitted that some of the globalist system made him money and that he manipulated that system, but he's exposing it, saying, let's stop it. But Obama's implying some little communist can lead us out of this. No. Or that, you know, here's the difference. Trump wants you to have air conditioning in a car and a nice house in the future and upward mobility. Obama says you can't have that. So, see, that's why you're not qualified, buddy, because you don't want us to have that. You want to control us, and you admit that's your plan. Austerity. While your wife's hanging out at palaces. As we speak, with royalty, pigging out while our kids eat food worse than prisoner food. It's all training us to accept less, lowering expectations, a post-industrial world, a new dark age. That's what the UN Biological Diversity Assessment 1996 calls for. Not a world, Winston, that gets more beautiful and more technological and stronger, a world that gets uglier and stupider and more stunted. You want an image of the future, Winston? It's a boot stomping on a human face forever. Don't look at me, Winston, and see the black circles around my eyes and see how ugly and weak I am, expressing myself and dying, that I torture people 18 hours a day and I have a horrible life. That's the beauty of the satanic evil of the priest of power ripping apart humanity. We're here to hurt humans. We're here to suck your guts out. Understand now? Yeah, they're like demons from hell, just right on that dimensional line, just trying to get control as fast as they can. And the Chinese communists are their most precious. They got the highest death rates, the execution vans, the giant human chimera facilities, the cows producing human milk, the just hell forces. It's the most just soulless evil. Just It's just the globalists are just, that's the big cauldron, the big command base. Prepare the weapons. Give them all the ports. Give them everything. Give them the weapons. Give them the communications. Give them the back doors. Give them the politicians. And Kissinger and them, they're going, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I mean, think of the allegory as like the golden child when the top demon goes in and gets down and meditates and then the walls pull back and he's in hell. And he's like, what do I do, Lord?
Destroy the child. Corrupt them all.
This is their plan, people. These are demons. Just like the Bible says, it's basically an intergalactic invasion into this space through people. I'm telling you, it's what all the ancients said. It's what they warned of. It's what we're dealing with. They're demons. They're freaking interdimensional invaders, okay? I'll just say it. Make fun of me all you want on CNN or wherever, but everyone already innately knows this. These people are not freaking humans, okay? Hillary Clinton is a goddamn demon. Excuse me, taking the word. It's not taking it in vain. She is a demon damned to hell. Excuse me. I said I'd play the Trump speech. I don't even know if I can go to calls now. I'm too upset. All I know is whether they're interdimensional demons or whatever they are. Let's say that's an allegory. All I know is they're the same thing. Psychopaths operate. They're not human. I don't like them. Okay? And my very humanity just like, yeah, take them on. But you want to fight? You're going to get one, you inhuman, soulless pieces of trash. I see you real good. And I know our species is stronger than you and better than you. We're going to beat your ass. Get that through your head. Excuse me. I shouldn't even, let's just go to the Donald Trump speech. Here it is.
Hillary Clinton and her campaign of fear will try to spread the lie that these actions will start a trade war. We already have a trade war, and we're losing badly, badly. She has it completely backwards. Hillary Clinton unleashed a trade war against the American worker when she supported one terrible deal after another, from NAFTA to China to South Korea. It doesn't matter. No matter where she went, the American worker was hurt. And you will be hurt worse than ever before if she becomes president of the United States. That I can tell you.
They live, folks.
A Trump administration will end that war by getting a fair deal for the American people and the American worker. The era of economic surrender will finally be over. It'll be over. You're not going to see it anymore. Although, I can't guarantee it, because after me, they'll probably start doing it again. But we will have four and maybe eight great, great, great productive years, and we'll never go back, and we'll make sure we never go back. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody. I appreciate it. A new era of prosperity will finally begin. America will be independent once more. Independent once more. Doesn't that sound great? Under a Trump presidency, the American worker will finally have a president who will protect them and fight for them. We will stand up to trade cheating. Cheating. Cheaters, that's what they are. Cheaters. We will stand up to trade cheating anywhere and everywhere it threatens the American job.
That's right. You don't harass American producers anymore and then give the commie Chinese a blank check so their slaves can make stuff.
We will make America the best place in the world to start a business. We'll hire workers and we'll open factories and we'll get rid of these horrible regulations that make it impossible to do business in this country.
That's right. By design, the politicians moved to China where they made deals. They actually do that.
This will also include massive tax reform to lift the crushing burdens on American workers and businesses. We will also get rid of all of these rules and all of these problems and all of the bureaucracy, which are destroying, absolutely destroying, our job creation capacity, which we used to be the best in the world, and now we're getting close to the bottom, folks. We're getting close to the bottom. Many people think that these regulations are an even greater impediment than the fact that we are one of the highest taxed nations in the world. We're also going to fully capture America's tremendous energy capacity. This will create for our workers, and that's what we want, for our workers,
cheaper power,
growth for our economy, and begin reducing our budget deficits, which are massive.
All right, let's stop right there. I'm going to play more after I take some of your calls, but that's why I harp on power plants. If they've shut down roughly half our coal power plants, they're totally clean, have scrubbers, nothing comes out but water and carbon dioxide. It's the cheapest power in the world, 3 or 4 times cheaper than anything else. No one else can compete with it. That's why natural gas and big oil, all give money to shut down coal. They're the ones. And then when I'm against shutting down coal, they go, oh, you're paid for by the oil companies. Go look at who funds it. It's the oil companies. I don't have any investment in coal. My investment is in if China is able to have dirty coal and no scrubbers, and their power is 3, 4, some cases 5 times cheaper than ours. If I was a factory builder, would I build a factory in the U.S. with power 4 times more, when that's pretty much one of your number one costs, or would I go to China? You're basically forced to. We produce shirts here in America. I get them from American Apparel. They're like $14 a piece. We sell them for like $25. And then people don't buy them because they cost more than the shirts we get made in Mexico. And I get stuff made in Latin America. At least they get some of the money down there. And you know, I try to be a moral person, folks. They don't really grow good coffee in the U.S., so I get it from the Chiapas. And they're communists, but at least they're rebels and own guns and are kind of like anarchist communists. So at least, you know, I'm supporting people that aren't going along with an evil even greater. I don't even want to get off into it anymore. It just gives me a headache. I mean, I'm in the exact same position as Trump, but on a smaller level where, okay, I got Made in America apparel for you. Don't want it. Because you want the shirt that's, you know, $15 that costs $5 to make in the U.S., in Mexico or in Venezuela or Nicaragua or El Salvador or wherever. It's cost me $5. I sell it for $15. I make $10. I buy it from American Apparel for $14, $15, sell it for $25. And you don't just make the same amount of money. People just don't buy it. So then you have T-shirts sitting there. That's like you said. He said, if I could make these ties here in the U.S. instead of Mexico, they acted like it was like, you know, he'd been caught. Oh, you're this anti-Mexican guy, but your ties are made in Mexico. And he went, well, of course they're made in Mexico. I'm not against Mexicans. I bought them down there. It's high quality. It's cheaper. No one will buy ties that expensive in the U.S. How is that bad that Trump is honest? That's what I'm saying. The point is we're pointing out the system is designed to be impossible. And so he goes off into coal power plants and the rest of it. The war on coal. The number one thing shutting us down isn't just the high taxes and regulations. It's the expensive energy. Have you looked at your power bill the last 5, 6, 7 years? Have you looked at your insurance bill? We're all being screwed, folks. We're being shut down. Because we have the communist Chinese and others that don't want to just win in a market war. They want to break us and dominate us and capture us and own our debt. And the crime is so big, they can't arrest Hillary for being a Chinese spy. It'd be too big. They should. They should arrest every one of those people. I'm telling you, thousands of those people deserve to be indicted. And I don't get on some power trip talking like that. I actually get sick at my stomach because we either start arresting them or they're going to push so hard that they're just going to force us to, they're going to come after us. I mean, they're not going to give us quarter. And people think, oh, well, let's just go along with them. No. That's what will destroy everybody. I'm going to go to break. And I had a special report coming up, but I'm going to hear it in the next hour. And then I'm going to go to your phone calls. But by the way, I want to put over Cleveland and over Philadelphia for 2 days each time during the RNC and DNC, $30,000 per 2 days, 4 aircraft flights, 1.5 apiece with a giant Hillary for President banner that's very visible. The banner itself is like 5,000. It's a gigantic banner. We're about to have it printed. We got to pull the trigger this week to get it done. I was trying to get blimps, but they're too expensive. I need you to buy the Hillary for President shirts. They're back in at full price, $19.95. They're like made in Venezuela, Nicaragua or something, but they're all printed and everything done here in the U.S. And so they're both U.S. and foreign. And I need everybody to buy them right now so that we can fund that, putting those aircraft in the sky. Plus, it's a great shirt. We'll be back. Stay with us. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central. We're here. Back weeknights, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars, Nightly News. Back Sundays, 4 to 6 p.m. with a live transmission as well. I'm your host, Alex Jones. All right, I'm going to your phone calls. More of the Trump speech coming up where we left off. Next hour, we have a guest popping in, Gary Haven, one of my good friends, and a very successful fellow that's a multi-billionaire in private business, but a patriot who's been financing movies, TV shows, you name it, trying to expose the globalist agenda. I wanted to get him in just to talk about the whole nature of the world. He only comes on like once or twice a year, and I thought, start popping in every month or two. So this is part of a visit he's going to have regularly with us whenever he's here in Austin. He lives here in Austin, of course, Australia and other areas. He's a private pilot and flies his own big wide-body jets around the world. So he'll give us his inside take on what's going on, the latest intel he's gathered from the strata of folks that he travels in. And then at the bottom of the hour, in the fourth hour, David Knight's hosting, we're going to air a special report I did on the Global Destabilization Program. I shot this 2 days ago. It's got a lot of clips, a lot of documents. It's very important. David Knight will air that at approximately 2:33 today. Is about, an hour and a half out from where we are right now, or actually about 2 hours out from where we are right now. I do want to go to your phone calls on this incredibly historic speech. I watch more mainstream TV than I used to because I realized that I was blinding myself to a lot of globalist propaganda. Just watching aggregate YouTube clips, just reading transcripts of speeches, or just reading white papers, I was missing things. And so I probably watch an hour and a half of news a day, and maybe 30 minutes to an hour of entertainment programs and movies just randomly to monitor what's going on. I also watch commercials and things like that to get kind of the compendium or the spectrum of what's going on, not just little pieces. And not only were they not calling this any type of Islamic terror or ISIS on all these different channels this morning, I saw it once watching over an hour. It was just like somebody blew stuff up and shot a bunch of people in Turkey. Gee, wonder who it could be. Oh, we better have checkpoints all over America. Take more of your rights. Talk about lying by omission. But I was watching every one of those channels wanting to see, because I shot a video last night about how amazing Donald Trump's economic independence speech was. It was a huge declaration of independence, and it was a declaration of independence against the modern globalist tip of the spear attack on us. It's economic warfare. And I would watch CNN, I would watch Fox, and they would just show a clip of him going, I admit it, I made a lot of money out of this system. As if he'd been caught in something. Out of an hour-long speech, that was it. Or just, yeah, we're going to have better trade deals. It was none of the bombshell, sensational, on-fire veritas, flaming truth of Hillary Clinton. We're under economic war from China, and Hillary Clinton is an agent against America in that war. Wow. Donald Trump called Hillary Clinton a communist Chinese spy, basically, which she is. I mean, I talked to a lot of retired and current top journalists, top spooks, you name it. And I've known for years, but they now they've made it very clear. They said, listen, Hillary is a Chinese communist agent. She's totally sold out to it. So is Kissinger. And it is on. They are pulling the stops out with their money laundered into the U.S., not just through her foundation. It's bad. And when they even catch, you know, Chinese Americans, which I know there's a lot of really loyal Chinese Americans, but if they've got family back in China, you can forget it, folks, because they threaten them. Inside the Navy, giving codes, you name it. You want to talk about who infiltrates, folks? It's the Chinese. I mean, the Chinese have infiltrated our government. They have infiltrated the infrastructure. They have infiltrated this country super bad. They're super smart, economic, savvy, you name it. And they are into money, very on average, worldly, very materialistic. So the globalists love it. It's perfect. They're the perfect biological robot, folks, to take over. And I'm not calling Chinese people biological robots. We can all act like biological robots. The point is, we're being programmed. They've chosen China as the beta test. where, again, if you go out to the park and get caught doing any Buddhist rituals or you get caught doing Falun Gong or whatever, they execute you and take your organs. They are horribly oppressed people. And they're in such control of this country now that 20 years ago, the Dalai Lama was a celebrity. Everybody was against what happened in Tibet. Now, most liberals hate him and call him all these names and spew a bunch of communist propaganda against the Dalai Lama. And the Dalai Lama isn't perfect, but he did come out and say, Germany shouldn't let in all these Muslims. They'll attack you and kill you because the Buddhists know all about what Muslims have done to them, including in Tibet. And yes, the Muslims have invaded Tibet to attack them. Okay, just fact. The Muslims always end up attacking when their numbers hit 5 to 10%. Okay? Tibet is right by Mongolia, folks. Research the Muslims in Mongolia. So, it's a serious situation. I want to go to your phone calls. Briefly, I'm not going to belabor this, but we normally do the special once a year because we already sell high-quality storable foods at the very lowest price you're going to find out there that are really high quality. And it's kind of a nexus point. Like, you can get stuff that even tastes better and even probably has more protein or whatever that's 3, 4, 5 times more. I mean, I can't even afford that. This is high-quality, good-tasting, nutritious, clean food that is lower than stuff that tastes like absolute crap and is old. This is fresh. This is new. We had to stop the 20 to 40% special a couple months ago because the folks at My Patriot Supply up in Utah that power it were actually running out of food. They don't sell food that's, you know, a month old. They don't stockpile it. They produce it. They sell it. So we had to stop that sale. But I saw all these reports about how FEMA's doing war games for 395% increase of food worldwide and how they believe this global depression's coming and all the signs. Whatever. It's insurance you can eat. Last 25 years. Everybody needs to get it. And so I twisted their arm and they said, okay, we've developed, you know, we've increased output. We've got enough to do this special again. And you know what? Even if some of the other distributors and suppliers don't like the fact that we're undercutting the market, you do so well in sales, we're going to let you do it again. That's the inside baseball. So you will not get anything near this anywhere else. The same food from My Patriot's great. We just contractually can put our label on it and go even lower. And we sell their food, the full spectrum of it, right next to InfoWars Select. It's the exact same food made at the same time, the whole nine yards. But this is why, I mean, that's why we've got non-GMO seeds and things in many cases lower than Amazon. No one can do that. We've created a big enough market, not on millions of items like Amazon, but on a few hundred items where we sell it so low that we become the dominant force in three different brands of gravity fed filters, number one distributor worldwide, three brands, and the number one distributor for My Patriot that's in the top three food suppliers in the country because of their quality and everything. So that's just how I operate. Free markets, what I believe in. If you've been waiting to get storable foods, great. Bad stuff doesn't happen. You can eat this or give it to the homeless or use it when you go camping. It comes in the best packaging. It lasts the longest. It's super high quality. It's what I have for my family. It's what I have for my crew. It's what I have here in our own facility. And I just bought more. And I bought stuff, you know, 10 years ago. And what I did was, even though it would last another decade or so, I just gave it to the Salvation Army and gave it to other groups. And they fed it to the homeless. They loved it. So it's just a donation down the road. You can even write it off as tax exempt down the road. A lot of states actually have tax exemptions if you do buy storable food because they're finally figuring out how important this is. While governments and elites dig in, they want to make us independent. They want to make us dependent on them. We need to be independent, economically independent, culturally independent, sovereignty, energy independent. That's what it's all about. So it starts with getting local government elected that's good, getting involved yourself, getting independent, planting a garden, turning the TV off more and more, educating your children, watching historical documentaries, not watching trash TV. I'm talking to myself here. I'm not lecturing you. But this is the way out of this matrix. So it's available at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com. And you can get the full spectrum of My Patriot, 20 to 40% off depending on what's packaged. It's not like we have one package that's 40% off, the rest is 20 or 30. Most of it is 30 or 40% off. There's some things we can't discount more than 20 because the profit's like 30, 40% total. And we just can't operate making 10% on this food. So, oh yeah, a lot of companies have markup 2-3 times. My Patriot's already the best deal. That's why we have them as a sponsor. I could have 10 sponsors that I'm endorsing for storable food. They're knocking down the doors. And there are some really upscale freeze-dried meats and things, fish and like salmon and beef I've been trying that I think I'm going to add as well. But the stuff's like five times more and worth it. But we're going to add some upscale food too, you know, but it's like gourmet. So I'm going to stop ranting. And speaking of plugs, I'm going right to your calls. I appreciate Mark and Steve and Chris and Sean and Mark, everybody holding on this epic Trump thing. But I see Leanne McAdoo has just come to the microphone. So I guess she's wearing a Hillary for President shirt, the new one that's in. Leanne McAdoo, thank you so much. What are you here to talk about today?
Well, I'm here to say the new shirts have arrived. These have a little shoulder flare on them so everyone can see you got it directly from Infowars.com. I know we've got a lot of people are making these shirts now, but it originated right here, so you can get yours with some shoulder flare. Hillary for prison.
Well, Leanne, that's just awesome, and I'm glad that you've helped us promote Hillary for prison. So has Biggs. We're seeing them everywhere. This meme is now number one last week in the country. When is Hillary going to prison? When is Hillary going to jail? This has really got them shook up. And now as the meme accelerates, it's just amazing. I want to thank all the listeners and viewers that have gotten it. And by the way, I'm not whistling the wolf whistle at you. At the shirt, that is a very nice shirt.
Hillary for prison. It's about time.
By the way, folks, just since Leanne's here, I just want to say this spontaneously. There's this internet rumor that Leanne and I have been dating or going out together. Leanne and I have shook hands and hugged each other maybe 10 times. But I am here whistling at the shirt. It's so beautiful. But no. Leanne and I have never dated. Isn't that correct, Leanne?
Yes, and we've actually only hugged once, and that was after you gave me a very nice Christmas bonus. Thank you.
Absolutely.
You're a good boss.
Leanne, am I screwing around here at work? Do I have time to run around the office and sit there and, you know, engage in forms of grab ass?
I mean, seriously, like, you are probably the busiest person. I think everyone here sees you maybe for 30 seconds after you're off the air. So I don't know. Where do you get all the time?
Well, we're here working. I've actually had people on the street say, hey, how's your girlfriend Leanne? And I'm like, so I just want to get that clear. That on my children, Leanne and I have never dated. Now one night when we were out to dinner with Buckley and his wife and some of the other crew, Leanne, you did give me a peck on the cheek.
What?
Yeah, but that was it. But you gave Buckley one too. So
I know. It wasn't terrible person.
Had you forgotten that?
Could be.
Well, I'm not going to sit here and say on my kids we've never dated or on my kids we've never done anything. You have pecked me on the cheek once, and that's it on my children. So.
Oh my God!
Okay, there you go.
There's the new internet rumor.
No, I mean, I'm kind of getting sick. I work out at home, but also go into a gym sometimes. And I had people at the gym ask me about, man, Leanne McAdoo, she's really a great reporter. She's gorgeous. You know, wow, is she your girlfriend? I asked, why are you saying that? Well, I heard that on the internet. So I just want to say, me and Leanne are not dating.
Yeah, well, thank you for addressing that. Because I work really hard to, you know, get by on my own accolades and then to have internet
number
rumors.
Number one, I'm a family guy. Number two, you know, just come on, folks.
Thanks, Alex.
Well,
you're a stand-up guy.
Absolutely, Leanne. No, we did not script this, did we?
No, hence my blushing.
Well, I mean, earlier I was just saying space aliens are possessing Hillary Clinton, so I kind of tell everybody what I really think today.
Let's just address all the rumors.
Alex Jones says Trump better not have sex with goblins.
Should I go ahead and shapeshift into my reptilian form now?
Yeah. I'm not saying that. I wasn't serious about the goblins. And actually, folks in the comments got it. They got that it was an esoteric thing when I talked about don't go with the succubus in political fornication, Hillary, the demon woman, go with Donald Trump. People actually finally got and they said, oh, this is Kabbalic. All that is archetypal. So all basic ancient religions are archetypals. I wasn't going with a Kabbalic reference there, but it does fit because I guess there's a Kabbalic perspective on that. I don't know if people saw my warning Donald Trump not to have sex with goblins video. But I actually didn't say that. I said, you're in the goblin lair battling them. I know you're going to get some goblin blood on you, but don't let me catch you kissing a goblin. So it was more family friendly.
Yes. Yeah. The little green goblin, I saw him dancing around. Very nice.
By the way. All right, I'm going to go to the phone calls. I apologize to everybody that I'm out of control today.
Everybody get your t-shirts.
Yeah, because here's the deal. They're full price, $19.95. I'd sell five times more, you know, at cost if I sold it, which I want to do to get the word out, kind of like, you know, a billboard for freedom. But we want to pay for 2 days, four flights a day of aircraft at the RNC and DNC. It's $30,000 a pop and $5,000 for the banner. And then I've got to have an emergency thing for $2,000 in case that banner gets torn then I've got to get another banner that's in the contract. So it's going to be great to have that there, Hillary for President, giant banners. It's not just a small banner behind the plane. It's gigantor. You know, it's those huge, big banners you normally see, like for Dos Equis or whatever. Leanne, I'm not, I don't always the most interesting man, but of course, when I'm not running NASA, I'm here running the show. But seriously, I'm being sarcastic here. Anything else you'd like to add?
Hillary for prison 2016, especially after this Benghazi report. I mean, she wants to move on. She says it's time to move on, but it's time to put Hillary in handcuffs.
Absolutely. All right. There goes Leanne McAdoo. Having some fun with that. No, I mean, when two or three people ask you in a week on the street if Leanne McAdoo's your girlfriend, it's time to go, hey, that isn't my girlfriend. We don't hire talented, beautiful female reporters here like it's a grazing section for me. Listen, I'm not Bill O'Reilly, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not. So even though he randomly accused me of bizarre stuff with no proof, and then he's the one that runs around having to settle all these different lawsuits and things. But I don't want to digress into Bill O'Reilly, and I apologize. I normally get goofy in the third or fourth hour. It's why I stopped doing the fourth hour. I got a lot of serious news to cover, and I apologize to the callers. I'm not going to do this anymore. It's wrong. It's bad. I will not do this anymore this week. But I'm skipping this network break. Go to Mark. Go to Steven. Go to Chris and go to Sean and go to another Mark and another Mark. Now, before I do that, just briefly, I tend to get more goofy and have more fun on air when I'm really concerned and really upset about what's happening. And I got home about 6 o'clock last night, and my children were already home from camp and stuff. Not one of Hillary's fun camps, but an exercise camp. Of course, those are camps for men she was talking about. See, this is all so surreal. We need to send men to fun camps. Sorry. She really did that, too. I like to say that. It sounds like a lie, but she really did that. She really wants national compulsory service, too, and get out of high school for the government for 3 years. I'm sorry. Become a social justice warrior like Trigglypuff. By the way, Paul says he's launching the ultimate Trigglypuff today that will be even greater than Trigglypuff. Has that happened yet? Anyways, I actually started crying last night. And let me explain something. I barely cried when grandfathers and grandmothers died. When I was younger, it hurt me. It really felt bad. I would be nostalgic and maybe get tears in my eyes driving down the road a month later thinking about them. Or, you know, go out in the old shed and see Grandpa's fishing rod and tackle box. And then one time I was back behind my grandmother's even before she died. My grandfather had been dead a few years. And he had this beautiful tackle box and all these fancy lures. A lot of them he made himself. And somehow they'd just gotten out of some shed, knocked out in the woods, tumped over. And I remember picking those up and bringing them into my grandmother, and she started crying when she saw them. I never really seen her cry over my grandfather, but it was the fact that I brought it in years later, and we sat there and cried over those fishing lures, and she said, just take those away or give them to your Uncle Joe. I can't look at those fishing lures. But what I'm saying is I guess as you get older, you get more sentimental, or either get sweeter as you get older, or you get meaner. And I was used to be pretty mean. So I've gotten sweeter as I get older, more sentimental. And I was sitting there looking at how innocent my kids were over dinner. And I was thinking about the New World Order and all the things they're setting up. And it's just, it's for sure that they've got to be stopped. And I really started crying. Not like sobbing, just tears started pouring out of my eyes because I'm grieving. Because I've studied history and I've also been heavily involved in covering things for 20 plus years. And I can tell you, I wish I wasn't right. I wish we weren't right. I wish we weren't in so much deep trouble. But it is very heartening to see Donald Trump standing up and telling the truth. And believe me, whether he knows it or not, I think he does know. In fact, I know he knows it. What he's doing is irrevocable. It's good. And so it can't be reversed. Even if he flip-flops later or does something wrong, and none of us are perfect, what he's doing now is real and is devastating the enemy. And no one should just sit by and go, oh, whatever, he's a politician. I'm not going to believe him. I'm not going to get fooled again. Normally, the Who song is true. But with what's happening with Trump at this epic moment in history, this is what history always shows. At the epic key junctures, you see fantastic things happen on the side of good and evil. And we're going to see some spectacular stuff out of evil, too, and some of its superpowers. I mean, this is going to be quite a battle, folks. This is the battle for the future of humanity. It started now. We're in it now. We're in the big move towards whatever the elite call it, the singularity. The Bible calls it Armageddon. They believe they become gods at the end of this. Well, those of us that understand that what's really going on, we know this. We're not living in boring times. And statistics show people are more bored than ever all over the world. I don't know what planet you're living on, baby. But I get why people are into sports and little kind of petty stuff, because you're in this galaxy with hundreds of billions of galaxies, trillions of galaxies around you now that they photographed. You're hurtling through space. You're born. You don't know where you came from, who you are, the mysteries of the world. There's all these religions telling you stuff. And it's just like, well, what? Where do I go when I die? What is this? What's happening? Well, the Bible says that you're a sentient creature made in the image of God, and that you have the power to build incredible systems, which we've now seen we were able to do, and that there are evil interdimensional entities that are fallen that want to take control of you to have you build them something in this dimension, a.k.a. Buckaroo Banzai. I curse you, Buckaroo Banzai. And whether that allegory is an accurate way to see it or whether it's the truth, when you do the deep enough research, you just come up to that point and you go, oh, wow. Every major religion said this is what's at the bottom of it. And you know what? The elite believe they're getting knowledge from the other side. And you know what? The Wedgwoods, the Galtons, the Huxleys, the Darwins, they all interbreeded about 200 years ago. And within 50 years, two or three generations in, most of the kids were mentally ill, brain dead, but others were super high IQs, had hallucinations all the time, and would just hallucinate and say, DNA double helix, biometrics, world government, here's the plan. And the British royalty would bring them in with their Royal Institute, and they would listen to this and say, okay, this is the plan, we're going to build it. And I know I sound crazy saying that. That's real history. They like interbred to create super beings that would be like antennas to get this advanced technology, and then they envisioned all this advanced technology, and then they deployed it, and had German scientists and others hired, and Russian scientists, who IQ-wise had even higher IQs, to build it. I mean, whoa, if that isn't science fiction, and then like, it's just like Avatar, where you got these people jacking into these bodies. That's basically what possession is. And again, I'm not saying I've seen that, or I know that, or I believe that. The elite believe that. At Skull and Bones in Bohemian Grove. Okay, that's it. I'm going to your calls. Let's talk to Mark in Illinois. We're all talking about Donald Trump. Go ahead. Thank you for holding. I've been out of control today. Go ahead.
That's all right, Alex. How you doing?
Good. Good, my friend. Go ahead.
I love you and I love your show. It's a beautiful day here in southern Illinois. Hardly any chemtrails today, which is amazing because most of the time they got the sky covered with them. And I want to say I don't fault you for giving Leanne a hug. She's a beautiful woman. She's a great reporter, too. All your reporters.
No, I know. But just when it becomes a distraction, you know, about that. And of course, then people say, oh, good, she's upset about it. Let's talk about it more. No, I'm just saying gossip about this show is a diversion from what the New World Order is up to, is my point.
I completely understand. And there's a couple points I want to make here, Alex. First, just let me say I've been listening to you for about 8 years now. I also listen to Jeff Reins, Hagman & Hagman, Steve Quayle, and quite a few people online and different other alternative media news outlets and stuff. And I've been listening for about 8 years. And the main point I want to make is that I just think these globalists are willing to do anything when it comes to, you know, to keeping power and staying in control.
Well, I mean, look at Hillary. She looks like central casting of a psychotic witch on a power trip. She's the Wicked Witch of the East, you know, meets up with Freddy Krueger, the Joker, and a frumpy weirdo woman, James Bond villain.
Yeah, it's crazy. And anybody that's voting for that woman, they have to absolutely know nothing about her. Either that or just not care.
Well, now she's worried about Islamophobia in a new speech. That article's up on Infowars.com. Hillary ignores Istanbul, ISIS attack, and focuses on revenge porn. Isn't that nice? And Islamophobia.
And they're allowing all this to happen. I mean, it's part of the collapse of civilization.
And they write white papers admitting it. Absolutely. But you could just be a delusional trendy and imagine she's your friend and imagine you're successful, like black Americans for Obama as their unemployment doubled. You could just be delusional. How about that? How about we just imagine that the moon's made of cheese together and be in make-believe land? But see, there's a real world and then there's make-believe land. The problem is the real world is so much more fantastical, beautiful, scary, exhilarating, evil, dark, fantastical, that the average person just can't understand it. Just like I sit there and make jokes about, you know, her being succubus and all the rest of it, and people can't get it. But then literary folks go, well, this is genius poetry. I'm not saying I'm always like that, but these people just don't know what they're getting or what they're hearing. It's pearls before swine, my friend. But Mark, you are no swine. And I love you. I appreciate your call, Stephen. Chris, Sean, Mark, and others. I'm going to try to take more of your calls now. Try to shut up a little bit. And there's all this other election news and so much more coming up. Gary Haven's going to be in studio as well. He likes taking phone calls. We'll take phone calls with Mr. Haven as well. I'm Alex Jones. Let's go ahead and take a phone call from Steve in Florida. The epic speech that Trump gave has been posted on DrudgeReport.com, Infowars.com. Really, that's one of the only places you're going to find it. They just have tiny snippets out of context that aren't powerful. You'd think the presidential frontrunner in dead heats in many polls would be numero uno. Nope. You think him saying Hillary's a Chinese agent and the era of our surrender is over, you think that'd be everywhere? No. So the battle now is to get his info out. Before they used to cover the speeches because they got such ratings, they're taking a dive now. They're losing money and just trying to show little snips and talk about him. Are the viewers even aware of that? Do they even know how they're being manipulated? They're making money off Trump and the Trump phenomenon, off populism while trying to kill it. Keep your friends close, your enemies closer. Stephen, in the great state of Florida, you're on the air worldwide.
Hey, Alex. Hey, I just want to let you know, this speech was an example of Donald Trump's raw charisma. And as a thinking person, he gets me pumped up and engaged. And we need a strong leader with that type of a talent. And I also wanted to let you know that that skit you did with Obama did with Jimmy Fallon on the TPP, to my knowledge, that originated from the old hip-hop song OPP, which was an abbreviation for other people's property. So it makes complete sense that someone like Obama would make a spoof on other people's property.
No, that's right. You down with OPP? You know me? Yeah, let's go rob people. Let's go steal. It's like from the 90s, if memory serves. But it's okay. It's just entertainment. That's where they're hitting you, is there. So they got the jazz band behind them. They're playing. And Fallon's like, you down with OPP? And he's like, yeah, you know me. And exactly, it's the biggest theft in history. But it's okay because we got some, you know, good-looking hip brothers and nice clothes with, you know, Mr. Fallon all good-looking and hip as well. And it's fall fun. In fact, let's play some of this weaponized garbage preying on that guy's moron audience. And again, they'll say, oh, this is entertainment. You can't even play our clip. I'm going to let Fallon and them know. Every time we play these clips that do copyright deals, I'm going to put you on notice right now. I'm going to sue you when you try to take us off air for playing this because you're engaged in politics. I bet you got paid money. I know Obama. I know they pay the Super Bowl to put this garbage on. I said that before they admitted it. I'm going to FOIA you, and I am going to sue you. I want to sue you for all the times you violate my rights when I try to analyze your entertainment shows. So, and I'm not a litigious person, but get off my back. Late, late show, whatever stupid program you are. Okay? You want to engage in politics and crap all over us and your viewers? We're going to show your freaking lies, you criminal. And you are a criminal up there with the president trying to sell the takeover of the U.S. by foreign multinationals in a secret deal. You're going to be known as traitors, just like with the euro. So you keep laughing, you slack dog piece of trash. Play the clip.
And that's why I negotiated the new trade deal called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP.
Now, hold on there, Fred Dispenser. Are you saying you're down with TPP?
Yeah, you know me.
You turn that off. Yeah, let me tell you. Yeah, black unemployment double, everything else, syphilis injections, all the tyranny, all the evil. Funding Africa to have basically forced abortions. You want money, everything else, but it's all right. TPP, big multinationals, admitted internet censorship, control, shut down of more jobs, screw over the third world. But it's all right, because we're all dressed up, nice evening. Down with the TPP. You know me, making it cool to be a slave. Making it cool to slit your family's throat. Sitting up there laughing at you with a bunch of useful idiots who don't even know what planet they're on. Glad you brought that up, Steve. We'll be back. And with us for the rest of the hour is Gary Haven in studio, who I've asked just to come in when he's in town in Austin. He lives here part of the time, other part of the time in Australia. So many of the elite, he's a patriot, but he is a billionaire, have been running off to Australia or New Zealand for whatever reason. We'll talk about that some with him in a moment. The film opened with a great test in 30 theaters, Armageddon, that I happen to be in, a lot of other great folks, in 30 theaters, and was number two in 27 of them with an average of 3.5 out of 5 stars. So that's good for the next phase. They've taken a break to roll out in even more theaters. They took a break during Memorial Day weekend and will reopen in 30 theaters in Florida, Detroit, and many other areas. And they will take another break July 4th and return another 30 theaters in L.A., San Diego, etc. DVD sales are set for October. And, of course, they've got some TV deals bubbling as well, to be able to just basically expose the globalist agenda. And well, I couldn't think of a better time with the British exit, with Trump coming out. Played it three times, folks. I may play it again, but in the next few days, I'm going to play pretty much all the speeches. Economic speech was the best yet. And you wanted to speak to that. I said, what do you want to talk about? I said, well, Trump and what's happening, but saying communist China is a trade war. The war is already here. It's already begun. We're being screwed over. Hillary is an agent of that war against us. That's a quote. She's an agent of that trade war, which is true. She is a communist agent. And, of course, they're not communists. They're just like Kim Jong-un. They're just thugs that rule slaves. They're slave masters. They're warlords. And a lot of American elites, including George Herbert Walker Bush, his ambassador, opened up China and made the deals with Kissinger. It's come out in major books, partially declassified, that Nixon wanted to open China but not have an inside screw job. And so that's why Kissinger and others got rid of Nixon. But here we are today. Saudi Arabia is second. Israel is down the line manipulating our internal politics as well. It's just a fact, not anti-Israel, but they shouldn't be doing it. But China is the one really censoring our media, stopping the sale of Savage's book a few years ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, I talked to Savage off air, and at first he didn't want to talk about it, and later he did talk about it. He wanted to come on about the censorship, but no, it was the publisher got threatened by the Chinese government and stuff. I've talked to folks in Hollywood. I mean, you've seen them not release Red Dawn for 2 years to take the Chinese out. Or to have the Martian come out, Gary, where we don't have rockets, but the communists do and give them to us. It's just, it's everywhere. It's insidious. And this woman sold out our missile secrets to them and more. You will see Trump soon come out on that. I told you they have internal polling showing Trump is neck and neck, 7 points or 10 points ahead in a bunch of scientific polls. They're doing real polls. Mm-hmm. I told you that Sunday and Monday. You notice yesterday it came out dead heat or ahead in real polls. So the truth is, these national polls, he's behind by 10 points. Pure bull. Gary Haven, good to have you here, my friend.
Thank you, Alex. Good to see you.
It's awesome to have you. Of course, I should say you are Amerigeddon the movie, a multi-billionaire businessman that started some of the biggest businesses out there, like Curves and others, the biggest franchise in world history. He sold it, of course, years ago, 10,000 locations. And it's just so many other great businesses you've launched. It's great to have you here.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. I'll tell you what, you just rolled out a whole bunch of topics for us to talk about.
You go ahead and take over. Don't pause or I'll jump in.
Okay.
By the way, I'm not gay or anything, but I mean, you're a handsome guy. It looks like you've been in a fountain of youth. And in the 3 years or so I've known you, it's like you're in a time machine going backwards. You look really happy. I guess being retired is good.
Yeah, it is.
And I just need to retire or something.
I'm having fun. And by the way, I get a comment. I've been paying attention to you and watching you. You've gotten really sensitive. And I'll make 2 points. Crying last night, you crying, it's just kind of a hard thing to picture. You're like a tough guy.
I think it's the intensification of the evil growing, and also I feel good rising. And it's so real now. It's like, it's not that I'm even sad. I don't even start weep. I mean, it's not like I start wrenching. It's weird. I just start crying. I don't know what that means.
We're Texans, right? You know, we're not allowed to do that. And
I'm just being truthful with the audience. I don't know what it means.
Yeah.
I look at how innocent my children are, and I just feel the great evil rising. And it's almost like I feel so strong wanting to fight it. And I'll be honest, all these perceptions open up discernment. And I just love God so much. I think it's the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I don't want to say that on air because it sounds like that's really what is the Holy Spirit.
You need to say that. And I tell you, that was the other thing I was going to mention.
We didn't talk about this previously, but I think you were about to go there.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I have been watching you openly talk about your faith, testify about your faith. And of course, you and I share the same faith, and we're serious about our faith. As Christians, you know, we have a passion for truth. Jesus was the author of truth. But I got to commend you. You've been bold and open about it over the last few weeks. And I tell you, we are in a serious time right now.
Well, it's not calculated. As the evil rises, I just automatically get closer to God, not even out of fear. I just feel God's power is just coming into the world.
Yeah. Well, and you're right. It is the Holy Spirit. And, you know, we're convicted to be obedient, speak the truth, to be a vessel for God to flow through.
I think that's it. I just feel God so strong. It's humbling.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I tell you, I'm proud of you.
Well, can you describe what that's like for you then? I mean, that is what it is.
Yeah. No, it is. And I tell you, it's interesting. People think that we're supposed to sacrifice for God. But Bibles were clear about that. God didn't want sacrifice, because what sacrifice does, it gives us a chance to take some credit for what we do. What he requires is obedience and boldness. And you and I have been willing to, in fact, it's impossible not to to step up and say the truth boldly, regardless of the consequences.
If you have a relationship with God, you're not a slave. You've turned over. You can't help it.
Yeah. No, tell you what, you're not even a servant. You're a child. You're a child of the King. And boy, that comes with responsibilities along with the privileges. And so I'm proud of you to be in your place to openly open your heart up and speak the truth about faith. And again, if you're going to be a prepper, the first thing you've got to do is prep your eternity. And you're really being a bold spokesperson.
Well, I want to be clear. I'm not on some high horse claiming I'm the best moral person or anything. I just, in my spiritual journey, it's getting so strong. And I talk to everybody else. They're either getting closer to God or they're getting into mental illness and evil. It's really a separation's happening.
Yeah, yeah.
What are you picking up along these lines, just spiritually, culturally, what's happening in government, what's happening in the world?
I sense that these birth pangs are getting more severe and more closely aligned, as the Bible would predict. We're at a point in time right now in history that's just amazing. And I'll go back to what you were talking about. This Trump movement and now this Brexit movement, and of course now they're talking about a Texit, which is highly unlikely, but still we're talking about it. People are waking up. There's a great awakening. You know, we thought it would happen spiritually, but it's interesting. It's actually happening politically. People are realizing their country has been stolen. More and more you hear in the common vernacular about a world government, about a world economy. And these are the people.
One of the heads of the CFR came out today and said, okay, we are an elite. It is world government. We need to have a war of the elite against the people. He actually said that. He said, we're losing. The populace are taking over. We're in trouble.
Yeah. And I tell you what, to openly be able to speak about it, people talk about Trump has given us permission to talk about politically incorrect things. Well, he's given us permission to do some other things too. And he set an example for all of us. We can now talk about world government and world economy without being ridiculed or being ostracized. We have permission to talk about it. The elite are doing it. They're open about it. So we can now talk about it too. And if we can get that into the vocabulary, we can get people to actually logically talk about this and say, look, if there's going to be a world government, what's it going to look like? Well, it's not going to be very pretty. It's going to be totalitarian. It's going to take away our sovereignty as individuals. In Europe right now, and I go there a lot, my company is in all the countries of Europe, there is a parliament there with the European Union that is inhabited by unelected, unaccountable people, a group of bureaucrats that are dictating to the Brits, at least up until now, you know, who was it they were going to let in their
country. And Obama's meeting in Canada with the three leaders of Mexico and Canada, and the Mexican president just called for an American union, which is already really in place. Yeah. And as you said, the European delegation's there meeting in secret. They've already formed it.
Well, you know, these movements, whether they're regional, like the North American Union, or whether they're worldwide, which would be, the Euro situation and all this, as they want us to move there, it means we relinquish our sovereignty. It means that we lose the accountability of the people that represent us. That is totalitarian, and that's what they have in mind. So the American people, if they care about their sovereignty, need to stand against these movements for North American unions, for European unions, for...
Exactly. So what happens now that the patriots, you know, everybody from Chuck Norris to yourself to myself, have been proven totally right? What happens now? I'm going to skip this break. Last one I'm skipping today. I mean, what happens now?
Well, first of all, we have got to take advantage of this opportunity. We've got to talk to our friends, our family, and we don't have to look like nuts anymore talking about this, these elite.
Like, we can be authoritative and say, we were proven right. Listen, you need to get on the bandwagon to save, you know, human sovereignty.
Yeah. And this is a last chance for freedom. And if we care about freedom, we now have to wake up, start talking, and all we have to do is point to what the elites are saying. You know, Obama talks about world government in his speech, and he goes to...
What about that paradox where they all admit world government, they admit it's tyrannical, but then they have media say we're crazy, it doesn't exist. I don't get that paradox.
Well, that's just it. The media can't get away with it anymore because it has become part of our common vernacular. Thanks to Trump, thanks to the elite themselves who now are blatantly talking about
it. And thanks to Drudge. Drudge has really helped mainline it.
Yeah, Drudge has been great.
Well, he's forced the media to not be able to ignore it.
Yeah. Yeah, we're living in really exciting times. And I tell you what, thanks to you, too. You have been, a lone voice, out there for a long time. And it's funny, mainstream is catching up to you now. So congratulations on that.
Well, I look, all I want is, like you said, I feel driven. I instinctively or spiritually.
Yeah.
It's like as they turn the heat up, the stronger they get, it's like automatically it's for every action, opposite, equal reaction. Mm-hmm. God, whatever, just gives me the insight, the understanding, the power to resist it. But then it's not a, it's the opposite of a power trip. It's very humbling to sit there. And as they up their power against us, God ups our power. And it's like, whoa.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the discernment, the understanding, it's like, man, this is hard to handle. I mean, not people understand the spiritual journey of the gifts God can give you and the things. It's just, it's really scary, actually.
Yeah. And you know, people have to realize this isn't a political battle. It's a spiritual battle. The elite of the elite are Satanists. They're Illuminati. They have a God, and it's not our God. And that's the ultimate battle. And the Bible talks about it. You know, in these end times, you know, Satan was going to be given his authority. And it's our job is children of the true King to stand up and do battle. And that's a great privilege for us. We get to be able to do battle with the ultimate enemy. And that's the times we're in right now.
ABC News, all of them say, of course everyone is going to have a microchip. They actually have anchors go up nationally. We played the clip like 10 times. Of course you're all getting chips now. When things collapse, you've got to have a chip. So clearly they're going to try to bring all this in. But if you read Revelations and look at it from your deep research, when do you think it's actually coming in? Who do you think it might be? How do you think it's going to manifest? When it talks about he only rules 1 year, I know some of that can be allegory or kind of a parable. Just Christ said, this isn't for them, the profane, it's for you. I mean, how long do you think as a discerning, smart guy, Gary Haven, that this is going to go on for?
Yeah, and I'm pretty biblically literate. It's kind of neat. You get to...
Sure, but I don't want to just hear from some preacher who's been on his little seminary. A guy that's successful in the world, stood up against evil. I want your perspective.
Well, you know, I get to really compare my perspective to the biblical. And doing business in all these countries is kind of a neat... You know, it's almost like you get to verify it spiritually. You know, I think that the Trump movement is going to accelerate the timetable. You know, they had Hillary as a shoe-in. She was just going to carry on the global program and continue to diminish our freedoms. Let me take a sidetrack on this TPP thing, this Trans-Pacific Partnership. Trump came out about that this week in a very big way.
But that's okay if it's a foreign group taking over because they had rapper guys say it was fun.
Yeah, yeah.
It's okay because cool people said it was cool, yeah. It's cool to have foreigners run everything and screw us, yeah, yeah.
Well, here's the real problem with the TPP. It isn't just the jobs that are going to be transferred overseas, which is kind of the main headline on it. There's something more insidious about it. It's sovereignty. I think you and I have talked about this in the past. There's a tribunal that works for the TPP. It's made up of three corporate attorneys. And when a company loses profit as a result of something a sovereign state or nation did. I'll give you an example. When Australia made them put these horrible pictures on tobacco products, okay? Well, Philip Morris can go to the TPP tribunal, which I love that word,
and make them pay for the losses.
And say, we've had losses here, and that's all they have to do.
And that's in there.
That's exactly right. And this...
And hey, Australia should be able to put whatever it wants on the damn cigarette pack.
Well, not if you sign off on the TPP.
Not if you're down with TPP.
Same thing with Texas. You know, Texas is going to have a problem with a number of things. GMOs, okay? A lot of countries don't want the GMOs, Europe in particular. Well, it doesn't matter what the sovereign nation or state wants under the TPP.
In fact, that's the big one. They actually have said in those sections exactly that it could be billions per year per country. Like if Russia doesn't accept GMO, they want to be the world leader in organic. Wow, imagine having a leader like that. Say what you want about Putin. That's a pretty good idea.
So these idiots who want the TPP... I'm talking about establishment Republicans here, not just the Democrats. And we have to realize the establishment Republicans are bought and paid for. Well, these idiots want to give up our sovereignty as Texans.
I think they're traitors,
Americans.
Is what they are.
Yes, they are traitors. And the TPP,
you see them as idiots, but you're not a traitor. You just innately wouldn't want to screw somebody over.
Well, you know, I happen to like my freedom, and I happen to believe that sovereignty is the only thing that we have against authority. I'm proud to be a Texan. I'm proud to have a governor that makes an effort to defend us against the overreach of a federal government. But TPP does away with that because that tribunal then has absolute authority. Our state, our country cannot appeal. And when they find that we owe billions of dollars as a consequence of our legislation, they then collect the money. And there's nothing we can do to prevent
it. Oh, but it's okay. Her. Three secret lawyers. They kept it secret for years.
Yep.
We don't get to vote on it. It's okay. It's liberal. I mean, Obama was there with cool guys in jazz outfits with Jimmy Fallon. In fact, can we play that clip again? And by the way, the few times I play clips from the Late Late Show or any of these shows, they hit us with a copyright thing and threaten us and try to shut our channels down on YouTube and you name it. I'm putting them on notice here. This is fair use. You're pushing propaganda on entertainment shows with the president. I have a right to critique that and analyze it and speak to it. I don't want to air your stuff because it's so cool. We get an audience from it. I want to show Benedict Arnold, collaborator, traitors, making it cool to have a secret multinational take over everything. In fact, one admission they said from an earlier court case with the WTO they cited, as you know, in these filings was there was old local city-run hospitals in this one area of Western Europe. I think it was Switzerland, actually. And so they wanted to sue them, even though they weren't signatories to it, because they were going to build more of those hospitals. And multinationals said, well, we can't then come in and build our own hospitals because you're competing with us.
Mm-hmm.
And people say, well, that's good. That's privatization. No, privatization isn't come in and shut down our infrastructure and then just claim we have to pay you because we already had infrastructure.
No, no, it's not.
Well, plus, it's an outside group.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's play this bizarre. And again, people think I'm attacking Fallon. He's a talented, smart guy. I've seen clips that are funny. Okay, I don't really watch a lot of mainstream TV. But the point is, he's always got Obama on pushing, taking our guns, opening our borders up, making stuff cute. This is like having a Frenchman on French TV a month before Hitler invades. In 1941, saying, I like Hitler. We should have him run things. He's a nice guy. Are you down with Hitler? Yeah, you know me. I mean, it's that crazy. I take it very personal that they act like this treason is so cute. This is how they get it under the radar. Here it is.
That being said, the American people face an important decision this fall. The entire world is watching, and they look to us for stability and leadership. Now, I know some of the presidential candidates have been critical of my foreign policy.
You're supposed to pay money if you run an ad, and then go to the Federal Elections Commission.
But I believe it is of the utmost importance to work alongside other world leaders. That's why I signed the Iran nuclear deal.
It's a total screw job.
That's why we reopened diplomatic ties with Cuba. And that's why I negotiated the new trade deal called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP.
Now, hold on there, Fred Dispenser.
You know, they need to put a disclaimer there.
This is government propaganda. Hey,
paid spokesman.
yeah, you know me.
Other people's property.
Yep. So let me answer your question. I didn't get to the full answer there. So I think things are accelerating right now. You have a number of events. We're going to have an economic crash by design. You know, they've borrowed and spent, borrowed and
they've done it all over the world. This thing, yeah.
Oh, worse than any time in history.
When do you think it's coming? As a guy that's proven with money, you're a smart guy from nothing, making billions of dollars. What do you think they're going
to
do?
Well, I'm going to have to give you a bilateral answer here. Because Trump is such a threat to the status quo.
They might wait.
Actually, I think they may wait till his election is
and then blame him.
Okay. Then they undermine him by crashing the economy.
That's what I think, yeah.
If he wasn't winning, then they would wait because Hillary is going to continue on down the road.
So it may accelerate it, him getting in.
Right. I think a lot of things are accelerating.
Because they see populism growing. They want to nip it in the bud and make us dependent and go, oh, buyer's remorse. See globalism. You were against globalism, but now you're on the street. Yeah. Oh, come back to us. We'll take care of you.
Which is the theme. You know, the theme of all communists is... safety and prosperity. Okay, that's what they tout all the time. Now, when there's an economic crash, it's an opportunity to go cashless. And this is where the chip comes in. This is where the market.
They've got to bring down the old system to bring in the new. Yeah. And if you just take the chip or the new biometric ID, we'll get you the card. You'll get your money out of the bank, ma'am. But you can't do it until you go to the new digital SDR. Yeah. Let's talk about that with Gary Hibben, a smart cookie. AmerageddonTheMovie.com back in theaters coming up next week. Stay with us. But I look at the globalists who are so evil and so out to get people. And you speak to that, and we're talking about how in every actuary, every number, every statistic, it's well known that, quote, liberals and trendies don't give to charity. They steal more often because they're not true liberals. Gary Hibben, and I'm going to take some phone calls. You want to speak to that, my friend?
Yeah. You know, it was always amazing to me that when you look at the giving of these people that are supposed to be served, you know, the Democrats, Joe Biden is a great example. The 2 years before he was elected vice president, he earned $600,000 a year and gave a total of $75 a year to charity. And Obama gave less than 1% to charity. And yet
they're all known that they, none of them, Hillary, Obama, don't give tips. They treat people like crap.
Yeah.
When it's not on camera. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, absolutely right. You know, evangelical Christians average 10% giving. Normal Christians, about 8%. And I think the number for liberals is 4%.
Or even lower. I mean, there's a statistic. Poorer conservatives, more generous than wealthy liberals, new study. Yeah. Liberals are 6 times more likely to steal and 6 times more likely not to give, but to claim they give.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's you know, there's the facts. And, you know, I
just feel compelled to give.
Yeah. Well, you know, I have a cargo plane and I feed 10,000 children in Haiti every day.
That's why I brought it up. I know you've given most of your money to charity.
Yeah. And I found this out, that 94% of the money donated to the Clinton Fund for Haiti, 94% of it was spent on the Clintons.
I was about to say, the media said 55, but now it's coming out. But it's okay, because she smiles and says, I love black people.
Yeah. Yeah,
while talk about that. I even talked to Sean Penn one time about that. He admitted that to me, because he actually was trying to help some.
Yeah, in fact, I crossed paths with him down there. He's really dedicated to Haiti. There's a good example of a liberal who's actually putting in his time and his money.
But he's not that smart. It's like, I'm like, but the Clintons are doing it. And he goes, yeah, but he just doesn't get it. Like, he's a good guy, but he's...
Yeah.
I hate to call him dumb, but I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I may see him again. I tell you, I'm proud. He sleeps in a tent down there.
Yeah. No, and he wears a gun.
Yeah.
Well, he's against us having, he wears a Sig Sauer, but he's afraid of having a gun up here.
Yeah.
Like, I can't have a gun, but you got a gun.
Yeah. Contradictions.
He just is committed to the Democrats.
Yeah.
But he's actually doing good stuff in his life. But sorry. So Sean Penn really gives, like, I think it's like a third of his fortune to Haiti. He's a good guy. Bono says he's raising billions for Africans or whatever, and he doesn't give, you know, 1% or whatever. Speak about that, though. Speak about the giving you've been involved in.
Well, I've been giving since when I was poor. Many years ago, I would donate my time at the local food bank. So once I became wealthy, feeding people was important to me. And so ever since the earthquake, 2 weeks after the earthquake, we have been feeding 10,000 children in Haiti every day. We send over 3 containers of corn, beans, and rice every month. I have an orphanage in India that's got 100 little children at that we educate and feed and take care of. But you know what? I'm not bragging about it. That's my privilege. I'm able to do it out of my abundance. Oh, by the way, there's a biblical law that says if resources can flow through you to meet the needs of others, you'll be given more resources.
Let me make a guess. Have you been given more resources?
Yes. I tested God, and he proved that to be fact.
But the elite, they know all this, but instead they claim they want to give, but they don't. It's
Well, they do want to give. They want to give your money.
To control the people they're giving it to.
Well, they want to give your money, my money, not their money. And that's the great hypocrisy of the whole thing. Now, I'm not a big Ted Cruz fan, right? Well, if you look at Ted Cruz's giving, it's abysmal. He claims to be a Christian, and his numbers are published on political giving or on charitable giving. And he gave, I think it was 0.8%, not even 1% of his income to charity.
By the way, you know, they snooped around about Trump and didn't publish the stories because it turns out he's obsessed with giving.
Yeah. Isn't that a great, great thing? But he doesn't tout it. He doesn't brag about it. He doesn't hold it up there, which I'm trying not to do right now. But
well, no, people that know him say, though, one of his biggest pleasures is giving, but also giving people really good jobs. Yeah. He loves to find people low level that are really talented and promoting them.
Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, he gives people opportunity. He gives people a safety net, not a hammock. And you know, there's a great story. His limo had a flat. I think it was on the Garden Parkway in New Jersey, and a bystander just pulled over, didn't know he was in it, helped the driver fix the tire, and then the next week, Trump paid the guy's mortgage off.
Absolutely.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Well, that's like, you say what you want about Mel Gibson, it never really came out till later, in fact, never came out, but like the children's hospitals all over the country, kids that need livers, kids that need brain surgery, he spent, reportedly, it's like something like $100 million on kids' surgeries.
Yeah.
And I know that from inside baseball. I don't think anybody even actually knows that. A few of them have come out. Say what you want about Mel Gibson. That guy's for real. You know, and he's a maniac and you know, blows up. But people that are real, though, have those extremes, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I didn't know that about Mel, but I'm a big fan of him otherwise.
You know, he's making a second Passion of the Christ.
Wow. That was an important movie.
Gary Haven's our guest. I want to go to some calls. I know, folks, I ran up against the hour, and then I got there, and Chris has been holding for a long time, and so has Mark, and so has Reed and Rob and Sean and others. I know you like taking phone calls. You want to take some phone calls?
You bet.
Before we do that, I'm going to make you plug Amerageddon, which I am blown away by this. It was number two in 27 out of 30 theaters you put it in. Wow.
Yeah, that was with the George Clooney movie being number three, which I'm pretty proud of.
Wow. I know there's a lot of inside baseball manipulations to keep Liberty Films, Christian Films out, but if you can get them through, it becomes like God's Not Dead and, you know, reaches a billion people. And then if you're able to do that and make billions, you could put it into a whole production company. I guess that's probably the plan. I haven't talked to you about it, but I know how your brain works. I mean, this is a big deal, though. I mean, if it was number two in 27 or 30 theaters, what do we do next? That's success numbers to any distributor.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I've got to brag a little bit. Our ancillary distributor is Sony Pictures. And there's a good example. Hollywood has been resistant to our movie, but money talks. And so Sony Pictures is bringing our movie out into pay TV and DVD in October. You know, let me tell everybody about the movie.
So these numbers show it is successful, so we get a big push on the internet.
Yeah.
Big push on TV.
Yeah. And so, and that's where the most people are touched by the movie. You know, this movie, Amerageddon, is about an EMP attack on America, an electromagnetic pulse. That is a real threat to this country that most people are unaware of. There's been two congressional studies that...
And I agree it's a real threat, but it's almost a dual metaphor because in the globalists are the real threat. Because it sells it to the mainstream as an EMP movie, but then underlying it's...
Yeah, you're right. There were two purposes of making the movie. One was to teach people about the threat and hopefully to create a movement to do something to protect us. You know, it's a lousy $2 billion protects the grid. Hillary wants to spend...
we need surge protectors, you know, between the power grid.
Yeah. Hillary wants to spend hundreds of billions on bringing in unvetted refugees. We're asking for a lousy $2 billion to protect the grid, harden the grid, so that 90% of Americans don't die for
it. And you're not asking for it. It was Hillary. She'd want the money. You're just saying Congress do it.
Yeah. Now, and of course, the second point you brought up was the other part of it. You know, is our government just inept? Is it just, you know, what's the deal? Why are they not doing anything about it? And I believe that there is a movement in this country by the elitists, by the globalists, to diminish America. In fact, Kissinger said himself, the only thing standing away at a new world order is a strong America. So they have a plan to diminish America, whether it's opening the borders, whether it's bringing unvetted refugees.
200 years ago, the British and the Europeans said, the American system of free market's too good. We can't compete with it. We must destroy the American system.
Yeah.
Well, good luck. 200 years later, you still ain't done it yet.
Well, the current globalists have almost accomplished it with all these lousy...
Look at our country and all the choices and freedom compared to North Korea. You stupid socialist Bernie people. I mean, shut up, you lazy dumb. I mean, I just... God. I'm sorry. Excuse me.
Yeah, yeah. If he thinks socialism's so great, he needs to go visit Venezuela.
So how do we make this film go even bigger then?
Well, you know, a lot of people have gone to see the film and brought their friends, and that's what's important. You need to go to the website to see where it's showing. It's AmerageddonTheMovie.com. Go to theaters. And every week there'll be different theaters as we move across the country. Tell your friends about it. It's a chance for you to bring your friends and let them see the evidence of what the globalists are doing to diminish, to put your children at risk. And if we create a movement, which we're well on our way to doing, and thanks to Alex who's been...
Oh, no, don't even thank me. You
know, who actually stars in the movie, by the
way. But we're all on this together. I know you want to thank me. You're nice. I want to thank you, too. But, I mean, if we don't beat this world, we're going to lose. It's an enemy attacking us. I better be fighting these people. I mean, that's why I'm against people thanking me. I better be fighting 100%. We're being overrun here.
Well, you know, your audience have won.
Yeah, they're who I want to thank. They are awesome.
Yes.
In fact, let's thank them, Gary. Look at them. I know you're doing awesome. I mean, they are incredible.
Guys, thanks for all the support for Alex. Thanks for the support for the movie. We're in this together, and this is our time. Trump has stood up and let people know that we might dare be able to take our country back. So these are exciting times to be in.
Yeah, people say, oh, he might not be for real. What he's saying, you can't walk back. Whether he was whoever he is, thank God it's being said.
I tell you, it's exciting. The speech police that have prevented us from saying things like world government or world economic system, the speech police have been shut down by the
CFR, and I've been reading Foreign Affairs for 25 years, are in panic mode saying, we're losing. We've got to stop this. and they openly declare war. I have the article right here that one of the top number two guy in the CFR said, the Bloomingdale's heir says, we must wage war on nationalism. They have just, they're not even hiding it now. You say, oh, you're a friend. They're our enemy. Destroy them. Well, thank God they ran up their flag. Good. Let's get this fight going.
Yeah.
Let's fix bayonets. You want to fight? You're going to get one.
You know, if people need proof on this, read the mission statement of the Council on Foreign Relations. Read the mission statement of the Trilateral Commission. These guys are open about what they're trying to
do. I had Rothkopf in front of John Harman, the head of the Kissinger Group, openly go, come to New York, Alex, work with us, it's all right. You're an elitist like us. And he heard it all. And when I didn't sell out on the phone during an interview, he came back and said, oh, you're crazy, and got off the air. He just thought, sell out to me, and I just roll over on my, you know, on my back. I just, that's crazy, man.
Yep.
But I guess so many people just roll over to them.
A lot of people, you know, and they roll over to it for prestige. They roll over to it for profit, or they roll over in fear. By the way, I need to share a story.
Share it, then we'll go to calls, please.
Mike Norris was out promoting the movie this last week, and he was all over the Eastern U.S.
That's accomplished director, firstborn son of Chuck Norris, who learned to ride a motorcycle with Steve McQueen.
Yeah. So he ends up almost in a hospital.
Oh my God.
Last night.
I didn't know that.
His glands had swollen up. His face was swollen, hives.
Oh, I didn't know this. Wow.
And he thought back, and he remembered the night before at one of the openings that a man in a gray suit had put his hand on his shoulder and rubbed his neck. So we don't know exactly.
No, I've had I never told the story, but I got poisoned at least twice.
Yeah.
At events.
Yeah, well, Mike believes he was poisoned.
I'm not just saying this. That's what happened to me. I swole up.
Yeah.
After.
Glands.
Yeah.
Because your body's fighting off that, you know, that attack, that toxin.
What happened? Tell me.
Well, he went to the doctor, got.
My hands all swole up, everything.
Yeah. Face red, blotched, couldn't breathe.
Yeah, don't let folks touch you when you're out in public, folks. If you're doing a public event, you're a leader. Go ahead. Yeah.
Thanks to steroid shots, you can. Breathe now, swelling's gone down, and he seems like he's on the other side.
Start over, because you just sprung this on me. We didn't talk this before, right?
Yeah,
you didn't tell me this before.
No, in fact,
start over.
I only found out about 20 minutes ago. Yeah, I talked to Mike a while ago, and he just gotten back from the physician, and he had been touched by a man in a gray suit.
He was at a premiere.
At a premiere, and didn't pay any attention till he woke up in the middle of the night. With his glands swollen, his throat swollen shut, his face blotched, hands swollen, realized that perhaps it was a result of this strange man in a gray suit. Why do you wear a suit to a theater? It's kind of an odd thing.
Well, his dad told him, I can only say this because he told part of it on air, Chuck Norris told him, don't you think Chuck Norris would be running for president, folks, if he had a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes? And... You know, he told him, he said, yeah, and I'm proud of this movie. Now get ready for him to try to kill you. Remember?
Yeah.
And Mike talks about that here on air. And then, you know, Chuck even said more behind the scenes. Imagine what Chuck Norris has gone through. And Chuck's been really writing some bold articles about what's going on. But, wow, it's funny you said swelled up because the first time it happened, I was doing these events and stuff. I'd only been on air like 3 or 4 years, but they were really packed full of people. And I swole all up and then after the event. Almost ran off the road going home, almost had to call the hospital. I never had allergic responses in my life. Then it happened again, and then I got a phone call on my home line that nobody had, and they said, listen, you son of a bitch. I've never told the story. It sounds crazy. You think you just swole up for no reason. Next time, we're going to give you a fatal dose. So I think that was it's crazy you said swole up, because that's what they do.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, this is a real thing. You know, Mitch and Mike went to his dad and told him about the movie Chuck Norris. And his dad said, Mike, I'd ask you something. Are you willing to die for this?
That was it, yeah.
Yeah. So, and Mike said, he thought about it, seriously.
Have you learned what Chuck thinks about this yet?
He didn't know about it yet. It just happened.
He was in the hospital. Where was this again?
He got back to Dallas yesterday and either went to the ER or went to his physician, and they had to inject him with steroids.
Yeah, I'll be honest. I don't really – the thing is, I do get fearless, mission-oriented. It's not like I'm tough or anything. I just don't think once I'm out in a crowd of people, it just happens.
Yeah.
It's actually a bad – I see it. It's not as an attribute to be fearless. It's like not having nerve endings. It's really stupid. And I've been at these events and things, and all the experts say, don't drink anything people give you. Don't people just watch out what you're doing. You know, look out, because that's a classic thing they do. The mafia used to kill folks with pure nicotine. They just squirt some of it on your shirt and go through and kill you, make you have a heart attack. It's just like, what's the point of going to speak to some group of 1,000 people, but I can talk to millions every day and just not put myself at risk, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, this is a pretty safe way to do it. Although, you know,
the thing is, they did it to me twice. This is like 18 years ago. And then they called up and said, dumbass, do you not get it?
Yeah.
They actually told me. So, that's why when you said swole up and stuff, they did this, I was like, what?
Well, you know, any of us that are speaking the truth to power have to be willing to weigh the risk. It's just part of the territory.
Well, what they'll do is, I'm told, they'll put like a little rubber piece over the finger. It's like a tiny condom or whatever. Or like that stuff the bookkeepers use to flip the paper.
Yeah.
So they don't get the poison on them. They put a little drop of that and they just touch you.
Yep.
With whatever these compounds are. And that's why, like, these people always, it sounds crazy. I probably had this happen 15 times where I'd be at events, signing DVDs or whatever. It's quite frankly why I quit doing it. People ask why. I'm not even really scared of it, but why go out and deal with it? And a guy comes and goes, let's blow up the police department and kill people. I have bombs outside. And I'll go, hey, get a camera. This guy's in. And we go out, it's a cop car or a Fed. You know, it just gets to the point where it's like, really? You know, I'm not going to blow anything up. Oh, my God. I don't want to. I've known you for years. Never told a story. I mean, I totally believe you and Mike. We need to get Mike on about this. I hope they don't scare him off of this.
No. No, he's weighed everything.
Well, your film is getting number two in 27 of 30 theaters. And it's about to have a huge TV deal and stuff. No wonder they're scared. My God. But I think if they kill Mike Norris, that'll bring Chuck Norris out of retirement. We're talking to Mike Norris right now about going into overdrive with David Knight in the next hour and taking your phone calls. Maybe getting Mike Norris, who just got out of the hospital today, on. We just learned about this. Chuck Norris' son, major TV and movie producer over the years. The director, one of the co-producers with Mr. Haven of Amerigeddon. And you know, it was funny. I talked about NSA whistleblowers coming to me, but they weren't NSA. They were corporate whistleblowers putting NSA equipment in. And this is all on record, these shows, interviews I did, the stuff I exposed, like in 96, 97, 98. And that was like in 98 that I got poisoned twice. Didn't know I swelled up after events where I've been shaking hands and stuff and you know, everything. And was like, calling my dad up. He's like, take Benadryl, all this stuff. And the second time they said, quit what you're doing, you know, you idiot. We've already poisoned you twice. And then I just said, go to hell. And it kind of went away, thank God. I got physically attacked once, too, and IRS stuff and the rest of it. But that's how serious they get. I mean, this isn't a game. I don't think people understand that. Absolutely. Guys, is this mic on? Yeah, they killed JFK in front of everybody. But we can't be intimidated by that.
No. That's kind of the secret of being a Christian. Nothing happens to us unless it's allowed by our God. And I'm sure you're still here for that reason. I know that I am. I mean, I've been...
It's weird. It's not an arrogant thought. I just know I'm going to be here as long as God wants me to be. And so I feel invincible.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what? That's confidence. And we can't act in confidence.
And it isn't that I think I can't be beaten. It's that I know it's in God's hands.
Yeah. You know, He will only allow them to touch you when he chooses to do that. And I know I've had divine protection. You know, I've lost an engine in airplanes and middle of the night crashed on Padre Island and walked away. And, you know, when it's your time, it's your time.
It's very humbling, too, that if God decides to let them take me out for some greater good, I'm not mad at God.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, we can't worry about it. We're going to go one day. Why not go out with, you remember Zig Ziglar?
Yes.
He and I were personal friends.
Oh, wow.
He was a mentor of mine. And he said he wants to go through life. And of course, he died a couple of years ago, and I think he accomplished it. He wants to go through life, instead of walking around the bases intact with, you know, his clothes nice and clean, he wants to run those bases ragged, beat up, come sliding into home, yelling, man, what a ride.
And I think that's what I want, too.
Me, too.
While with battle axes, we crush globalists.
Yep.
Listen, Amerigeddon, people need to be part of the film. It's been a success. I want to thank folks for that.
Mike's ready to call in.
We do have Mike Norris on the phone. We're about to go to break, so I want to hold him into the fourth hour. We want to break in a minute and a half. Infowars.com/show. Some stations don't carry the fourth hour. Most of them do. David Knight will then come in. I have a special report that Rob News stayed up like a couple nights doing. He was really kind of upset yesterday. I said, Rob, relax. We can put it out later. He goes, no, I really like this report. So he stayed up all these days to do it. Rob is so dedicated about the Spirit of Liberty, so that's going to air at the bottom of the next hour with David Knight riding a shotgun. And I want to take a few calls, too, since Reed and Chris and Mark and Sean and Rob, everybody's been holding, so I want to honor your calls, but a lot of unforeseen stuff has happened. Gary Haven is our guest. Just very briefly, the meter's always running here. We've gone up to like 60-something crew members, 7 or 8 contractors. Not that I want to expand. I have to have reporters be able to go all over the world. We're about to do some stuff that I'm just going to leave it at that. With war coverage, with coverage of
the convention,
coverage of the conventions, coverage of, I'm not going to say it yet, but we're going to do some stuff that is, I'm doing it, but it's going to be world changing. So just, and folks, you've seen us deliver. So we're not playing games. We're potentially doing some things that are the biggest we've ever done times the next level. I mean, we're talking exponential. And so your support, get the Hillary for President shirt, and the new version is in InfoWarsStore.com. Get 24% off on InfoWars Select, super high quality herbal food. We normally offer that once a year because of things being so crazy. We're offering it again. We got the producer to allow us to do this for a limited time. And get the books, the videos, so much more, InfoWarsStore.com. Get prepared, be self-sufficient. We'll be back with the fourth hour straight ahead in 70 seconds with Mike Norris, who just got out of the hospital. Now, folks, you know that these guys have been on the show many times. There's never been any drama like this. I told a story earlier that happened to me twice, that I'd go to events and then swell up and get all sick. I mean, I've been bit by bees, don't have allergic reactions. I'm not allergic to anything. And, well, I'm mildly allergic to opiates. I had a broken leg once they gave to me and made me throw up. But I'm not allergic to a lot of stuff. And I went to events, shook hands, did stuff, DVD signings, and would swell up and like 6-7 hours later and almost die. And once my dad had to actually take me to the hospital. And then I got a call saying, listen, you bastard, and in some other words, we're going to kill you next. That was on purpose. And that's what they do. They put a little rubber thing on their finger with the toxin, touch you, and you just got the call that the director of Amerageddon, Mike Norris, son of Chuck Norris, had just got out of the hospital. He'd been at a show. Somebody touched him, he thought, on the neck with a suit, just thoughts, and then he swole up later and got really sick. Mike Norris can barely talk. He joins us right now. Mike, tell us what happened, my friend.
Well, hey, I appreciate you guys having me on. It's been a great show with Gary. I just love listening to you guys. But, you know, I went to Florida after the shooting in Orlando, and it was very important for me to show the people that were going to see our film that I'm there with you, I support you. So I hit every theater we were in Florida in a 5-day period. Then we got called to go to Ohio. And in a show at Columbus, we had a sold-out house at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It was crazy. People love the film. I'm talking to everybody, and everybody's dressed in shorts and, you know, just very casual. And a guy, it didn't even dawn on me. And a guy in a charcoal gray suit, no tie, came up behind me, kind of patted me on the shoulder, and kind of, it's what he said. He goes, interesting film, and walked away. 12 hours later, I just feel something kind of on my neck. And I'm going, what the heck is this? And I was heading home the next morning. But when I woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning in Dayton, Ohio, or in Columbus, Ohio, my eyes were swollen shut. I could barely breathe through my throat. Wow. I thought, I've got to get home. And so I flew home, went right to the hospital. And they said it was some sort of, external. It was something that hit the outside of my skin that made it spread. And so thank God I was shot full of cortisone, whatever the doctors did. And so I feel better today, but it was a wake up call. But I'll tell you, I'm not deterred. I'm going to do everything I can to get this film. This film came from Gary Haven's mind. It is so important, and I will do anything to get it out there. And I'm going back out there. This is not going to scare me.
Well, you're a chip off the old block. I learned. Has your dad learned of this yet?
No, I haven't.
Because I remember you here like 2 years ago. Your dad said, "Hey, you know, good job. Are you willing to die for this?"
Yeah, and you know, in theory, you think you know, I'm a big tough guy. Yeah, I am. But you know, my destiny's assured. I know that, and I really feel this movie is so important for people to see and to understand what. The government does not have our best interest in mind. And if this was a nefarious act that somebody did on me, shame on him. But they will not scare me. They will not scare me. I will not be deterred, but I will have somebody watching me a little more closely.
Well, I know they're upset by the big theater deals and the movie deals and the TV deals that are being made because it's getting number 2 in 27 of the first theaters, the 30 it was shown in. I mean, with numbers like this is really going to go big in the next launch.
Yeah, and we'll get it back out there after the 4th of July weekend. And, you know, it's tough right now. It's tough, but you know what? We will persevere. And I come hell or high water. This movie is important. And
Mike, stay there. I know you just got out of the hospital and having trouble talking, but I want to just finish up on the other side. I'm Alex Jones, Gary Haben, the producer and one of the major stars of the film Armageddon's here. And I never told that story, folks, because I tell you, I've been through some stuff, but I've had him poison me twice. I hate to talk about it, but it's real. Stay with us. I'm talking to Gary Haben here about our mutual growing up in the DFW area, which was like gladiator school for Spartacus. And he's over here telling me his stories. I'm telling him mine. It's like, wow. I moved down here to Austin. I was in high school 5 years. My dad sold his dental offices. He owned two of them. Moved down here to get me out of trouble.
You were in a five-year program?
I was in the five-year program. And I learned kind of you were in that program, too. I didn't know that.
Well, actually, I was in a three-year. They asked me to leave military school the last time I had junior year.
Exactly. What do you think it is so rough about Dallas? I think about the stuff I went through. It's like another world.
Yeah. You know, unfortunately, Dallas is one of the few areas in Texas that we've created a dependency class. You know, and they're entitled, and you know, they look at people that actually produce, and then there's envy, and then you know the rest of the story.
How many fights do you have to get in?
Well, in military school, I went to TMI. Lived in the dorm with 350 juvenile delinquents for 3 years. And I tell you, I didn't have to fight too often because the first day of my freshman year when I walked in the door, a senior came to me and pushed me and started to slap me around. And there was a 90-pound lamp on the desk, and I gave him a concussion with it.
You got a killer instinct. That's what I do.
Yeah. And so
I don't get in a fight and just have this big, long fight. I try to take somebody out.
Yeah, and if you're going to fight, there's no rules. You know, and my dad was a boxer, a Marine, and grew up in the roughest situation. There's no rules, and I don't pick fights. I'm a nice guy. In fact, I always support the underdog. But when somebody wants to harm me, they're going to. And it kind of brings us to where we're at today. You know, we have a lot of threats towards us. As Mike
so emotional, Mike. Let's get back to Mike Norris. The stuff behind the scenes. We got to put a camera in here just during the scenes. And the behind the scenes, I mean, it's so crazy. Like an app or something. You get to see what goes on. Because people could just hear. John Harmon, come on the mic real quick. John Harmon at GCN, been my board op for 15 years. Done a great job. He's now a producer, one of the head sales guys down there, but he still runs my show because he loves it. What is it like for you, Harmon, to hear the behind-the-scenes conversations here?
It is absolutely unreal. There's so many crazy events that have happened over the... I mean, you just can't... You go home and you try to explain to people, like, hey, I did this at work. It's absolutely insane, the stuff you hear off air.
Did you not hear Rothkopf try to get me to join the New World Order?
Absolutely. Tried to recruit you. And, yeah. I mean, it literally happened.
The thing is...
This stuff is very real.
I think about the stuff that goes on in my life, and it's like, this isn't real.
It's like a movie. Absolutely.
Yeah. Let's go back real quick here to Mike Norris. Mike, I know you just got out of the hospital. God bless you. You're hearing all these stories. You grew up, you know, with your dad's karate school fighting every day out in California, and crazies coming by the house with their swords. I think you told those stories. But finishing up, that's right, hearing about you get somebody touches you, you swell up. I mean, it just all clicks. Where is all this going from here? What do you think of what's happening currently?
You know what? I pressed on. I just look at myself as somebody on the front lines out right now with this film, trying to get it out there. That's my mission right now. You know, I just admire Gary and you guys so much with your vast knowledge. You know, I wasn't as awake as I was 2 years ago. I'm more awake now than I was 2 years ago, and it's still a continual learning experience for me to find out what's going on. And from information I get from you, a lot from Gary, I mean, he's very persistent. Read this, understand this, this is what's going on. I mean, that's how wise he is, and that's how much I respect him and you.
Well, I just love hanging out with Gary. I tell you, there's a lot of cool people I've gotten to know in this, and you and Gary are just some of the finest people out there. Problem is, we're all too busy fighting globalists to ever go out and get dinner. But that's the greatest part about being a patriot. And I'm not saying we're perfect, but let me tell you, people that are fighting the New World Order are the most genuine, real, tough, John Wayne-type folks, a very race, color, and creed, compared to these... I'm sorry, I'm not bashing humpbacks, but I mean, spiritually, these humpback demons like Hillary Clinton and Obama, I mean, thank God we're not like this trash.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. But see, they hate the fact that we even exist.
Yeah. You know, one of the tough things is people like us and good people, we have trouble wrapping our minds around the unbelievable evil that these people, the baby killing, the killing,
the selling body parts.
I mean, we're at a weakness because we can't understand the evil that these people are. But we better wake up and try to.
That's right. I hate to do it. That's why I get so sad. I have to get in the mindset of the enemy, and I can do it. And I tell you, these are just pit of hell. I mean, these people are like a dimension portal.
Yeah, Hillary Clinton is actually a contender for the president of this country. That one woman crime wave who has a trail of murders behind her, including Benghazi, which we now hear some more details about. She's a contender for president in this country.
And then she's a Chinese communist spy.
It's amazing that she could even be considered for a dog catcher.
The problem is good men and women don't have a hunger for power. We're successful. We build things. We're happy. We just fade off into the... We don't want to control people. So what about that paradox, Mr. Norris? What about that paradox, Mr. Haven? What do we do about the problem in history that truly virtuous, hardworking, good people... Doesn't mean we're perfect, but we got goodwill. We like success. We don't dislike people because they're successful. We want prosperity. Yeah. How do we deal with the fact that we're blind to the enemy?
Mike?
Gary?
I mean, what do you do about that? Because it's,
you know,
just like...
I got to... My head went somewhere else for a second. I apologize. You know, if I could just back up one little second. When I was listening to the show, you were talking about Donald Trump and his philanthropy and his giving. I got to tell you, I've seen over and over and over again Gary do the exact same thing as Donald Trump, giving without anybody knowing, in the shadows, in the quiet. And then he made a comment about how he gives people a safety net and not a hammock. That resonated so deeply with me because that's what Gary's done with.
Teach him how to fish, don't give him fish.
Yep.
Yeah. And he said, you know, here's your net, no hammock. And he entrusted me with this. And that is the greatest compliment I could ever get. And that's why I'm not afraid to go out there when I've got patriots. And I've got people like that that have got my back. I will go out there, and I will continue to fight for this movie. And one little thing I did want to say, it's like all around we're getting turned and blocked in theaters. We had a great theater in Florida that at the last minute canceled on us.
Even though you're getting like number two, number one in most of the theaters, yeah. Sold out crowds are blocking it.
Yeah, they pulled us from the theater on a Wednesday when we were supposed to open on a Friday. And all we had was this theater in South Miami Beach in Cuban Town. I didn't care. You know what? It pissed me off. We've got to fight it. But it's just these little things that keep going on. I don't know who's doing it. Is it Hollywood? Is it the establishment? But obviously we've poked something and we've shaken up the beehive and they're starting to scatter on this. And if somebody truly, really tried to poison me, then bring it on. I'm ready.
Well, I'd like to spit some beach nut in that dude's eye and shoot him with my old 45 because a country boy can't survive.
Yes, sir. And as far as that other question, that would have to be answered by Gary.
All right. Well, Mike, we'll talk to you soon. Get better, yeah, brother, and be safe. I'll give it about a 90%. Thank you. About 90% chance he got poisoned.
Thank you, Mike.
You said swole up. Yeah. That's in the manuals. That's what they do.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, God, I went to this event and swole up, and this one's even worse.
Yeah, his lymph nodes swole.
My hands, neck, everything. It was like, yeah, you get bee stung. And then they called him and said, listen, you dumbass.
Yeah. Yeah. That's your body fighting.
Well, I went to the next event, and the guy's like, sometimes you get poisoned. I was like, signing stuff, and he's actually poisoning while he says it. And I'm like, and all of a sudden they go, don't you get, we told you we're poisoning. I didn't add that last little part because it's so crazy. Have you ever been poisoned, Alex? What? Excuse me? What? I said, have you ever been poisoned? Oh, how are you doing? It's like, just like the guy said, very interesting film. You know, like they like tell you what they're doing and when they do it.
Oh, I mean, interesting times.
I'll do like Tony Montana where they're wanting to blow up a little car full of little girls. And he says, you know what? I'm going to kill those kids, be warm like you. You die. But we're going to do that politically. That's what it comes down to. We're going to do it. And we're going to defeat him. All right, I'm going to skip this network break, go to David Knight. I want Reed and others. I want to go through these calls, but I want to cut into David Knight because he gets ready for this hour. And then, of course, he takes over the show a lot when we need him. So he does a great job. He doesn't mind. He's a team player. But we've got this special report coming up at the bottom of the hour as well. Gary Haven's here. But right now, let's go to Reed in North Carolina. Reed, you're on the air worldwide. Go ahead.
It's an honor to talk to two patriots, the founding fathers of the modern anti-globalist revolution of 2016.
I'm hoping those guys rise up so I can kind of go part-time, but okay, go ahead.
Amen.
Amen, brothers. Hey, couple things. The powers to be listening, especially the Trump people, we're not running against King O in this election. I think that's just going to be a dog whistle for his people. But 2.5 months away, we're going to be at the first debate, or just a short 3 months, September 26th. I don't think Hillary's going to end up doing as many debates as she would originally agree to, because if he starts waxing her, she's going to back out. Here's 2 points. I want to make sure we don't get off on all the topics typically covered in debates. This is one-time chance for America.
I agree. Trump should ignore the fake debate questions and savage her. And I've really been monitoring it, though. He gets some ratings, but now they only play short clips and then talk about him. They will not play lengthy clips of him now. Have you noticed that?
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Good point. You know, he's staying on message, and he never says Hillary. He says the criminal Hillary. And he's even bold enough to talk about Bill Clinton being a violent rapist, which no one's been
able
to talk about.
I mean, look, he's real.
Yeah.
What do you think's happened with Trump? The intel I was given is he's been a closet patriot forever. I mean, he used to give to anti-NAFTA, that stuff. The thing is, I've been told, I don't want to give this to the media, but they already know it. He's a listener. He's awake. He's been all this stuff behind the scenes.
You know,
I mean, Trump is really going for it all.
I think it goes back to what you and I were originally talking about. Trump's become a Christian.
Yeah.
And I think Trump has the Holy Spirit in him, raising him up for this time in this place. Reed, what do you think of that?
When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. And sometimes it's Saul of Tarsus.
Yeah.
It's King David. These aren't perfect men. They're men, though.
Yeah. In fact, God never used a perfect man except for Jesus.
That's right. But God tended, like I say, God loves drunks. God tended usually to use really kind of rough, gruff, tough guys.
Yeah. Well, God made a rough, tough world, and we're supposed to act in his image and in his character. So we're supposed to be, this is a battle. You know, even Jesus said, I didn't come to bring peace. I came to bring war.
That's right. Go ahead, caller. I'm sorry, Reed. Go ahead.
My subjects would be, guys, one subject, never Sharia. Plant that seed now. Make her swear she'll never let Sharia.
The mayor of London is making him go under Sharia, banning images of women who are wearing mini skirts on buses. I mean, Mike, I'm sorry.
And in America, in the future, when they try to implement this, in case Trump doesn't win. Number two, an infrastructure project's going to go down, whoever wins this presidency. And the positive would be if Trump runs it, can you imagine the prosperity? Here's two conditions we need to bring up in this debate. No illegals work on the next infrastructure national project. Number two, only maybe 50% union jobs. They'll object to both.
And again, it's not that we hate the illegals themselves. They're the symbol of exploiting them and exploiting us. It stops now. Good points, Reed. My issue with his wall, though, I get it would stop some people, but they'll just get longer ladders or go under. Why not just not give welfare to people that are illegal?
I mean, no, that's my exact. Yeah, the wall, I loved a lot of his ideas. But
that is a rhetorical stunt, right?
Yeah, and you know, he's not talking much about it anymore. All you got to quit doing is subsidizing financially, and then they'll go home. And then the other thing you do, I own a ranch, and I've got people that come across on visas. You know, what a novel idea. You just need to make the visa system where it's efficient, and they can come over and go home for Christmas and not...
I'm all for expanding it. We've killed all our kids with abortion. Bring in new people.
Yeah.
Just bring in hard-working, good, smart folks, not everybody with TB.
But you're exactly right. We need to teach Trump that. Quit subsidizing them, and they'll go home.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, you know, I've got people hired from Mexico as interns here who are smart, hardworking, great, came here legally. Mm-hmm. We love them. Mm-hmm. I don't use that as a stunt to say, oh, look, I got people from Mexico working in my office. They came here legal. They're smart. They do a great job. Yeah. They got the job because they're kicking ass.
Alejandro and I were at, I speak Spanish.
Yeah.
We were having a long conversation here the other day.
Absolutely. I don't usually use that as some set piece points. I don't care. Do the job. You're nice. Mm-hmm. I don't care where you're from. Just be here legally. All right, let's go ahead and take another call here. Let's talk to who's been holding the longest here. Who's been Mark in Canada. Mark, you're in Canada. You're on the air with Gary Haven of the Armageddon, the movie.com. Go ahead.
Hey, Gary. Hey, Alex. Great to talk to you both. Want to give my love out to Mike. Hope he's doing well.
Absolutely. That's scary, folks, because I know Mike's not a drama queen. He's pretty freaked out.
So, Alex, knowing that you're going to the DNC RNC, came across a bit of a hacked account thing online. They call it the Summer of Chaos. starts out talking about Mrs. Lynch recently.
They got leftists out stabbing people. I get it.
Yeah, saying they want to declare martial law and keep Obama in office with these people they're bringing in on buses, 68,000 expected to drive into Cleveland. So didn't know if you knew that or just give you a heads up.
I do. I'll be there. I'm going to be out there. And I'm not looking for trouble, but if any little communist tries to hit me over the head with a 2x4, they're going to get their jaw broken. You can believe that.
Excellent.
And I was invited too, but I'm not going.
Why that?
It's a little too exciting. Yeah, this is the perfect opportunity for a false flag.
It's so historical, though. Yeah. I hear you, though, but, I mean, what about Hillary, though? You know, all those little Bernie people that got, I mean, Bernie clearly won. They stole it from.
Yeah.
I mean, that's crazy.
Yeah, it's interesting. He hasn't endorsed her, but he said he'll vote for her. What does that mean?
Can you imagine communists watching two guys sitting there smoking cigars on TV? That has got to really upset them.
Especially if they knew where these were from.
These are unbelievably delicious. But it's the culture and the soil of where cigars originally came from. It's good, not the commies hijacked it in 1961.
That's exactly right. I like to think there's some beautiful women in an unnamed island that roll these, you know, with maybe nothing on, but a large hat.
Oh, my God. I'm sorry. Go ahead and finish up, Mark.
Yeah, no, and I just wanted to point out it's both DNC and RNC, and it's actually a whole message between a bunch of people on BLM from New York, it looks like, and says they're messing over Bernie and they have to push the rhetoric of Trump being a racist. So, you know, not much.
Oh, my gosh, not a racist. The Chinese government has mobile execution vans killing all the Buddhists, but that's okay. We're racist because we don't want open borders. Oh, my God.
Crazy.
It's the most intellectually bankrupt crap I've ever heard in my life. Thank you, Mark. Good points. Sean in Washington, you're on the air worldwide. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. First time, long time. Just a side note, that central casting comment you made earlier was hilarious and on point because I work for the industry and I know them well. And I'm going to.
Oh, yeah. Hillary Clinton could be like a lady that runs a mortuary that kidnaps kids and like dissects their brains on live TV to another dimension that demons watch. And that'd be the movie I'd cast her in, right?
Oh, yeah, she's right out of central casting for sure. And I'm going to do my best to promote the Armageddon movie. It looks like an amazing film, and I think a lot of people should see that film. I've seen the previews for it. And, yeah, that's...
Well, thank you, brother. What else is on your mind? Thanks for holding so long.
Oh, no problem. I just kind of wanted to relay how I came to be a Trump supporter. I wasn't at all when this first came to be. When
you weren't born a Trumpkin.
No, I wasn't born a Trumpkin, but I definitely am now. I mean, being a constitutionalist, I was obviously a Ron Paul supporter. I was a Ron Paul delegate last election, and so I was circling Rand this time around. He dropped out. And so I went to Ted Cruz, and then I started doing some research and found out what a snake oil salesman he was.
He's definitely a Bush dropping. He's like a Bush little pod child.
It's disgusting. And so I started doing some research on Trump and found out what a constitutionalist and a nationalist he really was, and how he did have the best interest of the American people at heart. And you can see that more and more.
Well, exactly. Look, what he's doing is irrevocable. No shill would be doing this. This is devastating. He saw the wave of populism. He's been a closet patriot. The evidence was there. He jumped on. He's committed. And he's going all the way. It's history. It's you know, they say that circumstances make the man. You got to already have the will to do it, the right stuff, but it's stepping into the circumstances that takes you to the next level. And Trump's only a manifestation of that. Gary Haven?
Yeah, you know, and he's fearless. You know, they killed a sitting president. He is a greater threat to the establishment, to the elitists, to the world movement.
Than Kennedy.
Than even Kennedy was. Man, this guy's got guts, and I admire that. I may not agree with all his policies.
And Private Joker might be silly and ignorant, but he's got guts, and guts is enough.
Yeah, and he's got enough money where he's not viable. So I'm excited about him, and I just hope and I pray that he is protected divinely.
I pray for Trump every day with my children. Well, that's the thing. People that are sold out and have no soul, I guess, or no spirit, they think, oh, my God, money. Why not sell that success or being on TV or whatever? It's like, they don't get how valuable it is to have real things you stand for that you know are right and not waver on those. That's the real that's the property. That's who you are. That's the real dimensional strength. These people are so blind. They have no idea. They think honor is just some stupid thing. They have no idea. It's the substance of everything. It's what civilization's built on.
You know, I think you hit on something. Trump is showing us honor. And I tell you what, we need to emulate, you know, his boldness, his honorableness, his fearlessness. This is our opportunity. He's given us permission to speak freely, and we need to take advantage of it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Sean. Look, we got Rob in Mississippi. We got Sarge. We got Steven. I was going to air this big special report, but I think we're going to air that on the nightly news tonight now, and I'll air it tomorrow during the show. It's like 15 minutes long. It's really powerful. Dude stayed up a couple nights late to do it. I was like, dude, just stop. You know, don't kill yourself. He was a little bit of a grumpy possum yesterday at the office. I understand that. The dude killed himself for this. That's why we're not going to air it. But we're going to put it on. We're going to put on the nightly news tonight and then YouTube. It'll be up on InfoWars.com because I want to give David, he's been sitting in the other studio for 30 minutes, all wound up, ready to go. Gary, I know you're trying. You need to go somewhere. He wants to say hi to David Knight, and then we'll,
oh, yeah,
in 5 minutes, and then we'll punch out, let him go. And then if he wants to, it's up to him. I know we talked to Rob in Mississippi, Sarge in Alabama, and Stephen in Florida, but really he's been holding the longest is Rob. We should at least get to Rob. But David Knight's coming up. I'm Alex Jones here with Gary Haven of AmerageddonTheMovie.com. We're with InfoWars.com. It's under attack by the New World Order. You might want to promote it. You know, I was thinking about going to see Merle Haggard and Willie Nelson in like Corpus Christi or something. We were looking at buying the tickets with Weldon Henson, one of my guys that works here. He's a big country music singer himself. They play him on XM, and he's got, you know, pretty big deals. But he still works here. He's been here like 12 years. Right after he got out of the Air Force, he came to work here before he started his band. But now it's almost so successful, he may have to leave. And we were talking about going down and listening to Merle Haggard and Willie Nelson. And I know Willie, been friends with him for years, but he kind of goes through the motions now. Merle Haggard's still like all there. And I was like, you know, let me think about it. And then boom, he died that weekend. But I was almost, I've never seen Merle Haggard.
Yeah, I hadn't either. That would have been a treat.
Kind of a bummer. Yeah, he's a great guy. Gary Haven, he's the producer, but also one of the major stars in AmerageddonTheMovie.com. And we've got David Knight here with us. David Knight, you've been sitting in the wings, ready to host the fourth hour. What do you make of all the epic things that are happening? I haven't talked to you yet today. You've been so busy. I've been so busy. You think I'm exaggerating how epic Trump's speech is, saying she's a communist Chinese spy working against America? Because it's true. It's over the top. But, you know, you got to tell the truth, even if it's over the top.
Oh, absolutely. And I think it was a great speech. And, you know, Alex, I can't remember the last time I've heard a presidential candidate really talk about the Constitution and talk about what it says. And talk about our independence. And that's what we saw in this speech. I've got an article here from the Wall Street Journal where they attack him for what they say is his 18th century protectionist views. But I would ask them, you know, why can't we have competition with insurance companies between states? We're supposed to have free trade in America. It's a good thing if we have free trade globally.
It's all
but we
managed
can't have free
BS.
Trade.
It's
exactly.
All managed crap.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, we had George Will making the rounds on all the talk shows this last weekend, and he's
the guy that
this
says that, that there's a sovereign Republican Party and screw the voters.
Yeah,
that guy that writes articles in the Washington Post.
That guy.
That is crazy kook.
That's right, and he's listing all of these libertarian economists as if he was a libertarian. Milton Friedman, all these others saying, you know, look at what they said about free trade, and Donald Trump wants to get rid of this, and it's like, you know what? There's nothing about free trade in this. You
don't it isn't free trade when a secret tribunal writes one-sided screw jobs.
That's right. It is managed crony capitalism, but yeah, to the extreme. And this is a global movement that's going on. People aren't talking about what's happened in Italy, what's happened in Iceland and elsewhere.
By the way, I forgot to say, it was 8 nations that won referendums. Now it's all 30.
Yeah.
I mean, this is exponential.
Well, we had 19 out of 20 mayoral elections in Italy that were won by a Eurosceptic party. 19 out of 20. All they'll talk about is that Rome has a woman mayor for the first time. They don't talk about why she was elected and why the other 18 out of 20. And she's a lefty. Yeah, she's a lefty, even though they're Eurosceptic. So they like to portray it as a far-right, extremist, xenophobic, racist movement. And yet here in Italy, it's all against that, okay? But it is a Eurosceptic movement.
By the way,
it's a move against globalism.
I got mobbed my first trip ever to Italy. I mean, they were like bigger listeners than walking around in Austin.
Yeah.
By the way, in Mexico, I'm not bragging about Alex Jones, but I was in Mexico for a week fishing on Cancun and Isla Mujeres. I was mobbed. The Mexicans loved me. And they were like super informed. They were like more informed than Americans.
Well, they're more desperate to have their country back than even we are. It's been stolen by the narco government in that country. By the way, David, good to see you, man. You did a great job on our movie, Armageddon.
Oh, thank you.
You do a great job here every day, too.
Well, thank you. Thank you for including me in it. That was great. I really enjoyed seeing it. Went to the premiere when it happened here in Austin.
And you took your family, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we all went.
It was amazing that it opened number two in the theaters it was in, 27 out of 30 theaters.
Yeah.
A lot of people there.
Well, David, I'm going to hand the baton to you, my friend. And if you choose to take these callers, I know it's sometimes hard to take my callers on your show, but if not callers, you can call back tomorrow. I apologize for getting everybody. Please remember, we're also listener supported. We're selling the new Hillary for President shirt at cost so that I can pay for putting airplanes 2 days in a row. So that'd be 4 days, 2 days in the RNC, 2 days in the DNC. It's $60,000 to do that, $30,000 per event, and then $5,000 for the banner, which they think will probably rip by the DNC. So they're recommending I buy two. So I think I'm going to fly Infowars.com one day, Hillary for President the next, but it's the big jumbo banners. It's the big fat ones. You normally see like beer ads on. It's not like a little skinny one. It's big, huge ones. And they're so they get like turbo props to do it so they can really drag a Gigantor one. It's really obnoxious. So I'm going to do it regardless, even though we might run out of money around here. By the way, I feel what's happening historically where this year, nothing bad about having profit to be secure and strong. I'm not even paid this year. And I intend now to look at the budget and not be paid this year and hire more editors, camera people, reporters, you name it, and you know, try to give raises to great folks who are doing good jobs around here. For you, the listeners who are supporting us, know I am so committed. I'm putting everything in I've got. And I've told Trump this through channels and on air. Trump, put $1 billion in. Like, you know, commit, because he's already committing his life. He's already risking his life. He's trying to raise money, you know, from grassroots. He doesn't want it from other rich people. I get it. I think Trump should really just commit and probably give 10% of his money. This is history. He's all in. His will is now tied into this. What do you think, Gary?
Yeah, you know, he needs to do it. But I tell you what, his fundraising is scary, abysmal. I read yesterday he's got $1.5 million in his account. Which
it's almost like sabotage inside there. I could raise him $1 million in a day. I mean, I don't know what's going on here.
Yeah, so he...
I've been told... I don't even want to tell people. I'm not allowed to talk. Go ahead.
Well, you know, the Republican Party needs to step up and do their part.
They're in there sabotaging him.
Oh, they are. But there's enough of us that can demand that these damned establishment Republicans support the party for a change, support us and our choice.
Oh, we're going to hold these people accountable later.
Yep. But he's got to get his fundraising in order. But
that makes it even more real that he isn't taking the big money and they're sabotaging him. I mean, he's obviously good. How could people not get behind Trump right now? They're insane if they don't.
Part of it is he said he didn't want any money because he didn't want to be bought and paid for. But he didn't make that clear that was just for the primary. The general election, Hillary's got $1 billion coming from all the moneyed interest, all of the elitists, all of the globalists. And the good news is Trump doesn't need $1 billion. He needs $500 million because he's got the truth on his side. And I guarantee you the truth is worth at least $500 million in this campaign.
And they've got all these fake super PACs out. He doesn't even have one gathering the money. It's even his enemies. It's hard to even get him the money when you want to.
Yeah, you know, I gave $1 million last presidential election, and I had to hold my nose to do it with Romney. But this time around, you know, if I can... and I've been invited to be three times to be on Trump's advisory committee. I was invited to go to the spiritual program they had in New York last week. I wasn't able to go. I need a few minutes with him. But this is the first time I've said it, I would write $1 million check.
Well, that's better than his people can do in a month. So, wow.
Well, there's a lot of people like me.
I know. I don't know how. Look, I don't like to get conspiratorial except when it fits. The way he's raising money means it's deliberate, because I know people like you that are ready to give him together like $10 million now. I could get him $10 million in a week.
Yeah.
So I just don't know how he's not doing that. It's crazy. We're ready to kick Hillary Clinton's ass.
Yeah. I'm going to ask him that question when I get a chance to sit down with
him. Well, I mean, you know, the people we thought were good getting in there, even folks that are very close to Trump that have worked with folks for years are saying we're really worried. They think they think people are getting threatened. You know, the new head of the campaign, people said is good and everything, but even folks that know him well are saying this doesn't make sense.
Well, he's good. You know, he's a brilliant CEO, and what that means is that he gathers the smartest people around him and then he makes the final decision. So he just didn't, he hadn't taken the time to develop his campaign contribution.
Well, sure, because in business, it's whoever did the best at jobs, you know, who was successful, you hire them. With this, it's like you're hiring from the political class a bunch of scum.
Yeah.
So you try to hire the least scummy.
Yeah.
Well, they were least scummy because they never got to get to the head of the trough. They just convert to, you know, inside deals immediately.
Yeah, you know, so many people are bought and paid for. You know, I know Karl Rove quite well. I've spent some time with him. Even Karl Rove is talking about getting behind Trump. You know, and that
should.
And Rove, I don't think he's the demon everybody talks about. He is a political operative who's committed to getting somebody elected. That's what he does.
He wants
to
win.
His gift is. Yeah, I think if Trump reaches out to him, that he'll get that army of people that know how to do this moving in Trump's direction. But he needs to reach out to him.
Well, he has the database.
You know what? I think I'm going to call Karl Rove and have this discussion now that you mentioned it.
Well, I mean, all I know is Karl Rove could raise $10 million in about 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
I can raise $10 million for Donald Trump in a week, and I'm not bragging. That's easy.
Yeah,
Rove. I don't understand how in hell he can't do this. I mean, I raised Ron Paul $5 million in one day. Ron Paul said that on air.
Wow.
I'm not bragging. I don't understand this. I mean, he can't raise $5 million in a month.
And Rove raised $350 million for Romney, the pathetic loser Romney, and he got him a third of $1 billion. So I think if he and Trump make nice, that Trump can get this thing moving. Because
and people say, oh, don't get dirty with him. This is the universe we're in. As long as Trump doesn't compromise on what he's going to do, I don't care where the money comes from. We got Hillary Clinton over here as a Chinese government agent. okay, Trump. Trump's kind of like, I don't want money from people. Adelson, before Adelson offered him $100 million, I was told a week before, and everybody always says Stone. A lot of this comes from Stone, some of it doesn't. But we'll just say this. Everything Stone's told me has come true. Stone's amazing. He goes, you know, well,
you introduced me to him, by the way, last time I was on air with you.
He wants to talk to you, by the way. The point is that $100 million? He goes, yeah, Adelson, the big guy's going to offer him $100 million. And about 2 weeks later, Adelson's in the news, $100 million, but it was strings attached. And he goes, Ted Gingrich is $200 million. And Trump said no, to his credit.
Yeah.
So that's like a third of the money he'd need to win or more.
Yeah.
And Trump, to his credit, that makes me like Trump more. But at a certain point, I'm like, well, I know he's a good guy. I want him to win. I'm the guy who's always against being involved in all this money, but he's got to have it. It's like rocket fuel to get to Mars.
Yeah.
Hillary's loading her rocket. She's got the fuel. He's got to get the fuel. I don't want to compromise. I don't want Trump to compromise. He's not compromising, but then I'm watching him not get the rocket fuel. What do we do?
Well, even with the truth, which is his greatest tool in his arsenal, he's got to get some money together. And he needs to get with it. The time's short.
I think he should just do it himself. I don't think there's any excuse here.
Yeah, and I don't think it's $1 billion. I think a half a billion plus the truth is.
Well, he's already put $45 million of his own money in.
Yeah, which is chump change, by the way. And it's amazing. He won the primary with chump change, but the general election,
his dad used to walk around picking up the extra nails at building projects, even when his dad was already worth hundreds of millions. And Trump got that tightwad thing from that, and I get that. He's good for charity, but he's a tightwad about business. He got to know. He's fully committed. He's got to just turn everything loose.
Yeah.
He's got to just, I mean, wouldn't you if you were this guy? What would you do with your fortune if you were in Trump's position?
I would leverage it. You know, and Trump's good about this. I read Art of the Deal years ago, and the way he makes his money is he uses other people's money. He doesn't put his own money at risk. That's how he built his business, and he's proud about that. That's how he needs to build his campaign. He needs to enlist other people. And I tell you what, when I donate to something like this, I have a catch too. I have a requirement, and it's called good government. That's all I want. I want good government. And there's so many people like me, wealthy people like me, who only want the same thing, just good government. You know, T. Boone Pickens is a friend of mine.
He's ready to get $40 million, I was told by his people.
Yep, and he doesn't want anything.
You know, nobody knows that, by the way.
I didn't know that either. I'm glad to hear that. He's a great.
Shouldn't have said that.
83 years old, billionaire.
Yeah, I spoke at an event he was at. Dallas.
Yeah, and so people like him, Drayton McLean, and these are just the
boys. Twilight Zone happened when I saw Dick Cheney walk by.
Well, Cheney, I think I read is supporting Trump now. Is that right?
Yeah, because he has no choice. But yeah.
Well, I don't know. Look at the Bushes. They seem to think they have a choice.
Well, the Bushes hate Cheney. I think Bushes are worse than Cheney. Quite frankly,
they are. You know, if people knew, you know. MK Ultra and all that kind of stuff. You know, we don't have time to talk about that.
Some bad people.
But the George H.W. Bush, boy, that, and I know him too. I've met him. He's a funny guy. But boy, what an evil son of a gun when it comes down to it.
Let's hand the baton to David Nye. Thanks for doing an hour and 47 minutes with us. Gary Haven, ArmageddonTheMovie.com, coming back in theaters next week. Have a great fourth, Gary, and thank you. Let's hand the baton to David Knight in the studio next door to us on the Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central.
Thank you, Alex. I want to get to our callers here. I'm going to go to Rob in Mississippi in just a moment. Before I do, I want to cover this story, what the Wall Street Journal was saying about Donald Trump, because I think it's very important how they break this down. Listen to what they said. This is our first paragraph. Trump pledged Tuesday to withdraw the U.S. from global trade alliances, saying he would exit NAFTA if it isn't renegotiated. He said he would label China a currency manipulator, and he would kill the TPP. Now, the Wall Street Journal thinks that's really bad. I think that is excellent. That's everything we've been saying. Look, you have to understand, the deception of the European Union was to come in and say, this is simply about trade. And I have Nigel Farage going to the European Union, and of course, they booed him soundly there at the beginning. And he gave him back pretty good. We're going to play that in this segment. We're going to do this on the Nightly News because we don't have time. I want to get to some of your callers. But the interesting thing about it is that he said, basically, you're in denial about what's happened. And the reason this has happened to you, he said this to the European Union in Parliament, as they're jeering him and booing him, he says, the reason this happened to you is because you sold this to people as an economic union when what you were doing all along was a political union. Even when people in France and elsewhere held referendums and said they didn't want any of your political union, you did it anyway. Every crisis that the European Union has created, whether it's the economic crisis or the immigration crisis, and now here again we see with Brexit, they always argue for closer political union. And that's what this has always been about. And he called them on that fundamental lie. And let me tell you something. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is not about free trade. It is about managed trade. And when you hear a liar like George Will going on the talk shows and saying, oh, look at all these economists, everything that the Republican Party has been about, our central premise here has been about free trade. But to say it is not free trade, it is managed. We already know how this works. We've seen the European Union. We've seen NAFTA. We know that they are building blocks. We know that we're going to the next level. And I have to say to you, on the issues that you don't agree with Donald Trump on, just as I've looked at this, you're not going to have a constitution. You're not going to have an America if you don't stop the globalism. Worldwide, people are pushing back against globalism. So we're going to talk about that tonight on the Nightly News. Just before I go to the caller, let me read you this paragraph as well from the Wall Street Journal. They say, it amounts to a wholesale rejection of longstanding Republican orthodoxy. And it leaves the party with a candidate arguing against the very policies most GOP leaders have enacted and supported. He spoke longingly about an 18th century economic policy when he said our original constitution did not even have an income tax. Instead, it had tariffs. Where have you heard that? We've talked about that many times. He's saying exactly what the people need to hear. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to go to as many of your calls as we can, starting with Rob in Mississippi. We'll be right back. Get to Rob in Mississippi first. Real quickly before we do, I just want to let you know that we have the InfoWars Select Storable Food Special, 20 to 40% off select foods at InfoWarsStore.com. That is back. That's a massive discount that you'll find there. And of course, that's in response to that FEMA report. And we're going to have a special report on that tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News about how they wargamed this and said, well, you know, what if this were to happen or this were to happen or this were to happen? Looking at it and saying, well, we got a 395% increase in food prices. They called it the food chain reaction. Food chain reaction. Get it? It's a simulation. But, of course, it's just a simulation, right? Except it's a simulation with all these inputs, these disruptive inputs that we see them doing as a matter of policy. Massive migration and other things. So they're basically wargaming what they're doing to us and then coming out the bottom line saying, you know, this might result in a 400% increase in food prices. So we put this back as a special 20 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food at InfoWarsStore.com. Let's go to your calls right now. Rob in Mississippi. Go ahead, Rob.
Hey, how you doing? Got out of the military a while ago. My wife stayed in. I was talking to her last night. She's actually deployed right now. And she said something concerning that concerned me. Basically said with the upcoming election, they put out a detail and asked a question for them saying that they're only taking males, but for 2 weeks up to a month before the election, to include the election, they're going to do a security detail.
Hmm. So what do you make of that when you say that they're going to do a security detail before the election? What is,
it concerns me because in the past, they've used her, they've used them. They took security detail for the Super Bowl, but I've never heard them use military for security detail for the election.
Well, that long. Okay. Centered around the election. I understand. I didn't get that at first. Okay. That's very interesting, isn't it? Very interesting.
Yeah.
Wow.
2 weeks, month. What are they? I mean, along with everything, with what's going on with Trump, what are they planning? You know?
Well, absolutely. And it truly is unprecedented. We've never had anybody speaking so plainly. We've never had anybody who is focused on how globalism is destroying us. And it is not simply Donald Trump. I mean, we see it with Nigel Farage. We see it with all these other countries in Europe. We see it unraveling because people understand what's going on. And we are at the very last opportunity to shut this thing down. If they go to the next stage of consolidation, it is going to be so much harder to get our freedom back. The more consolidated government gets, the worse it gets. And they're about to consolidate this into a world government with these trade partnerships that they're doing between the U.S. and Europe and the U.S. and Asia. Well, that's very important information, Rob. I certainly hope that they're not planning something. Let's go to Sarge in Alabama. Go ahead, Sarge.
Hey, how you doing today? I just love your show. I appreciate how you pick up for Alex.
Well, thank you. Thank you for listening. Go ahead.
If I could, for a moment, I'm in the outskirts of Montgomery. I moved up here from Destin a year ago, and it's like moving into a different world as far as the media is concerned. And what I'm talking about is the NASA-type control rooms the local media represent. You know, let's go to our Washington correspondent who's in the next room, and of course they don't say that. But down here in rural America where the rubber meets the road, you know, it's like cutting through a 10-foot steel wall with a 12-inch bar chainsaw to get people to understand what's going on.
Yeah.
And one of the things I'd like to say is the local media here actually, you know, represents itself to be doing such a great thing by bringing money to Selma, by keeping the racial divide alive. It's crazy. You know, this is like a different world from Destin when you listen to the media.
It truly is. It truly is a divide and conquer. I'm sorry we're out of time. Sorry to the other callers. And if you don't believe that it is divide and conquer, that they're worried about their political careers and their appearance more than anything else, look at the takeaway from Benghazi. Got people dying, and they're talking about their known fake narrative about it, having them change clothes multiple times because they're concerned about how it looks. Join us tonight, InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.